A very good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. There are no apologies this morning, and our first item of business today is to agree to take item 6, which is our review of evidence on today's agenda, in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. The next agenda item is consideration of evidence on an affirmative instrument, the Crime International Cooperation Act of 2003, designation of participating countries, Scotland Order of 2023. And I welcome to the meeting Keith Brown, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans, Vivian McCall, Policy Manager at the International Justice Cooperation Unit, and Ruth Swanson from the Scottish Government Legal Directorate, who's joining us remotely. So welcome to you all. And I refer members to paper number 1. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak to the instrument.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for the invitation to give evidence today in relation to the Crime International Cooperation Act 2003, designation of participating countries, Scotland Order 2023. And with your permission, Convener, I'd like to make a brief statement about the order and the mutual legal assistance. The order mirrors the Crime International Cooperation Act 2003, England and Wales and Northern Ireland Order 2022, which in this area of law allows collaboration across the UK jurisdictions to support cross-border operation and cooperation. In an increasingly interconnected world where crime operates without borders, it's never been more important to ensure robust international cooperation to promote justice and to help maintain public safety. The order before the committee will therefore enhance our international judicial cooperation framework, specifically in relation to mutual legal assistance. And before I explain the contents of the order, it may be helpful if I outline the context in which it's made. Mutual legal assistance is a formal name for how states request and obtain assistance in other jurisdictions for the investigation or prosecution of criminal offences. The UK as a whole is a party to the Council of Europe's 1959 European Convention on Mutual Assistance in Criminal Matters and its additional protocols. And these form an essential part in our fight against crime and our cooperation with other contracting parties in relation to criminal proceedings. MLA, as it's known, is an important tool in both domestic criminal proceedings and against transnational and international crime. The second additional protocol to the 1959 Convention broadens the scope of available mutual legal assistance amongst contracting parties. It includes specific provisions about requests for hearings by video or telephone conference, joint investigation teams, and the temporary transfer of prisoners. As a member of the Council of Europe, the UK ratified this additional protocol in 2010. Under our domestic framework, mutual legal assistance is governed by the Crime International Cooperation Act of 2003, referred to as the 2003 Act. And that Act states that for us to request and facilitate certain types of mutual legal assistance, the country in question must be designated as a participating country, as defined by Section 51 in brackets 2. The purpose of this order, therefore, is to designate as participating countries the following: Liechtenstein, Luxembourg, the Republic of Moldova, Switzerland, Turkey, Armenia, Chile, and Ukraine. All these countries have ratified the second additional protocol to the 1959 European Convention on Mutual Assistance in Criminal Matters. Designation of these countries will allow us to cooperate with them in relation to specific types of mutual legal assistance. This order only establishes the ability to provide or seek certain types of assistance to or from the reference countries. It does not create an obligation to do so. Incoming mutual legal assistance requests from a designated participating country are reviewed by the Crown Office in line with existing practices, and that includes a human rights assessment provided by the FCDO. I'll now detail the specific effect of the provisions for which these countries are to be designated. Firstly, designation for the purposes of Section 31 of and Paragraph 15 of Schedule 2 of the 2003 Act enables us to assist in requests for a person within Scotland to give evidence by telephone in criminal proceedings before a court in a participating country, where that witness gives their consent. Secondly, designation for the purposes of Sections 37 and 40 of the 2003 Act enables the Crown Office, on request from a participating country, to obtain customer and account information to assist an investigation in the participating country. and designations for the purpose of sections 43 and 44 of the Act are the reciprocal provisions, which enable Scottish authorities to make requests for similar information to a participating country. Additionally, designation under Section 45 provides that requests for assistance under Sections 43 and 44 must be sent to the Lord Advocate for transmission unless the request is urgent. Finally, Sections 47 and 48 make reciprocal provision for the temporary transfer of prisoners to or from a participating country to assist with an investigation, provided that the prisoner has given their consent to the transfer. In summary, this order will help strengthen our ability to investigate and prosecute criminality at home and abroad. Mutual legal assistance is a key tool in combating cross-border crime and ensuring justice for Scottish victims of crime. It's important that Scotland, as a good global citizen, plays its part in facilitating international justice cooperation to combat criminality. And being a good global citizen also entails standing with our friends to defend the rules-based order. And in that vein, I should also like to emphasise that this order deliberately does not designate Russia. Following the invasion of Ukraine, the Council of Europe expelled Russia, a decision that is unprecedented in its 73-year history. Although Russia ratified in the second additional protocol in 2019, on the 18th of January this year, the Russian President, Vladimir Putin, announced that he had begun the legislative process of terminating Russia's participation in 21 international agreements associated with the Council of Europe. And that was with retrospective effect from the 16th of March 2022, the date that Russia was formally excluded from membership of the Council. We understand that nothing has been lodged formally as yet, and my officials are awaiting formal confirmation. But Russia's unprovoked, premeditated and barbaric attack against Ukraine, a sovereign democratic state, removes any basis for the mutual trust and respect for international law that is essential for international judicial cooperation, and therefore we are not seeking to designate Russia at present. We remain committed to improving the provision of mutual legal assistance across borders, and this order will enhance the level of cooperation that we can offer to and seek from other countries. And I hope that these remarks will be helpful to the committee, and happy to try and answer any questions, Convener.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. So we'll just now move to questions. I'll open it up to members, and I see Pauline McNeill, and then I'll bring in Jamie Green.
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Thanks for that summary of the instrument in front of us. I don't have any particular issues in terms of not supporting it, and do welcome what you said, UK and Scotland not recognising Russia in the provisions for assistance. So that's to be welcomed. I suppose my question is that I was trying to ascertain from the paperwork as to what level of crime this would cover. Would it be all crime? I mean, given I'm taking from what you're saying, if the Lord Advocate's involved in certain proceedings, then I'm assuming that it'd be more serious crime. And since there would also be provisions in relation to bank account information, is that really where it's serious and organised crime? I just wanted to understand the parameters of the powers that the instrument would give.
Well, I'll ask the officials to come in, but I'm not aware of any area of crime that's not covered by it. You've mentioned quite rightly, as I have done, the customer account and information, so that's obviously to do with financial aspects of potential crime. But it does rely on the witnesses' cooperation in this case. But I'm not aware that it precludes any crimes being looked at. No.
So if it was shoplifting, theoretically,
well, anything
that would cover, it would be...
Yeah, we can't tell other countries what they might want to come to us and ask for the Lord Advocate and ask for, witnesses too. So any level of crime is possible, yeah.
OK, thank you.
OK, thank you very much. Jamie Green.
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I just wanted to ask some questions about the about Sections 47 and 48 of the 2003 Act, which I believe this amends, I'm not sure if it amends or specifically relates to, but it's around the issue which in the policy note states that this means that Scottish ministers will be able to facilitate the transfer of prisoners to and from these countries for assisting with the investigation of offences. That seems probably quite a benign statement, but I wondered first of all if that agreement already exists and it's simply that you're adding these countries to that agreement, and secondly, if if that agreement does not currently exist with those countries, but will do after this. Would that, for example, given that we are hosting a large amount of Ukrainian refugees who've obviously fled the war in their home country, and there have been some media reports of some of them already looking to perhaps instigate proceedings of crimes of war, proceedings against either Russia as a state or indeed individuals. If any of those complainants do make a complaint in Scotland, would this be required, for example, to move prisoners from Ukraine to Scotland, for example, for trial, or indeed vice versa, if there was ever to be discovered someone who had come here as a refugee, but it was found to be needed back home for investigations, would it be a two-way conversation? And would that also include people who are held as prisoners of war? And as by specific example, I would mean a Russian soldier who's in Ukraine, but maybe has been alleged of a crime by someone who's currently in Scotland. Would this then enable or facilitate their removal to Scotland? And how would that happen?
Well, I'll try and give my answer first, and then the officials will give you the correct answer, I'm sure. But so the purpose of this order is to designate these additional countries, and it's possible just now that each of those countries, and indeed any country, we could ask for that assistance, or another country could ask us without them being designated countries, and it's possible you could cooperate on that basis. But this gives added weight to it, because they are, all the countries you mentioned, are part of the international rules-based order. They're involved in the protocols which we have, so it gives more force to that. And I think it would tend to mean, in effect, although I've not been involved in these, it would go to the Lord Advocate, obviously, there would have to be quite good reasons for countries not to cooperate in that way, which perhaps, without being added to this list, the designated order, the reciprocal arrangements, you could more easily just dismiss it and not go along with that. So it gives that added weight. Having just answered Pauline McNeill about the range of crimes that might be covered, I think international war crimes would be different. I think that would be a different process that we'd have to undergo. And in relation to whether it's people from here who are Ukrainian going back to Ukraine or vice versa, just to bear in mind it's all, it has to be consensual under this order that the countries would have to agree. I'm not aware that the domestic law within Ukraine is operating as it normally would do for obvious reasons. And if it was about war crimes, I think there's a different process for that, which is started internationally. That's my understanding, but I don't know if officials want to add to that.
Yeah. I think what you were referring to perhaps is more on the extradition side. Yeah. That's separate from mutual legal assistance. Mutual legal assistance is looking for evidence rather than people, and it's a separate process.
The reason I ask that, though, is that the notes do state specifically that it will facilitate the transfer of prisoners to and from these countries, not necessarily evidence. Yes. So obviously Section 31 talks about giving evidence digitally or via video or telephony, which may make it easier for someone to participate in legal proceedings in another country. I understand that, but this, it does then go on to talk about the removal of people, not just information
just,
or words.
Just to give evidence.
Yeah, it's just to give evidence.
It's a temporary removal.
Oh, I see.
And that's the prisoner would have to consent to it as well.
Right. So it's nothing to do with extradition. Okay, that's fine. And just my other question was, in that scenario, would that be a request by ministers to the Lord Advocate or the other way around?
Well, MLA is a two-way process.
So who would give the authorisation, sorry, is what I'm getting at.
That'd be the Crown.
It ultimately would be the Crown, yeah. Not ministers. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, Russell Penley.
Yeah, in the policy note, it says that an instrument in similar terms has been made for the rest of the UK. What are the differences between that and this, or are there any?
So the list of countries is exactly the same. Russia, I think, has also been precluded by the UK government as well. It's just simply that we have a different jurisdiction, so there are no tangible differences that I'm aware of between ourselves and the rest of the UK.
OK. And there's another one. This isn't more of a kind of curiosity. On page 6, it talks about it will allow persons in the UK to give evidence via telephone to a court in any of these countries. Is it still by telephone? Would that be the case, or...?
It is. That's what's specified in the order. It's quite possible, of course, that evidence can be given in other ways, video conference and so on as well. But this specifies telephone. So that's where it will have an effect.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions, members? No? OK, thank you. So in that case, then, I'll invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion number 07936, that the Criminal Justice Committee recommends that the Crime International Cooperation Act of 2003 designation of participating countries Scotland Order of 2023 be approved.
Moved, Convener.
Thank you very much. So the question is that motion S6M number 07936 in the name of Keith Brown be agreed. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much indeed. Okay, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, and your officials for your time this morning. And we'll just have a brief suspension to allow the witnesses to leave. Thank you. Thank you very much, members. Our next agenda item is consideration of the following negative instrument. That's the Sexual Offences Act 2003, prescribed Police Stations Scotland Amendment Regulations of 2023. And I refer members to paper 2. Can I just ask if members have any questions on this instrument? Thank you. So are members content not to make any recommendation to the Parliament on the instrument? Okay, thank you very much. Thanks very much. So we'll just have a brief suspension to allow the room to be set up for our next agenda item. Thank you. Thank you very much, everyone. So our next item of business today is post-legislative scrutiny of the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act of 2018. And I refer members to papers 3 and 4. So I intend to allow around about an hour for each panel this morning. And I welcome our first panel of witnesses to the meeting. So we have Dr. Marcia Scott from Scottish Women's Aid, who's joining us remotely. Thank you, Dr. Scott. Dr. Claire Houghton from the University of Edinburgh, Professor Michelle Burnman from the University of Glasgow, and Amanda Mason partner with Harper McLeod. So a warm welcome to you all, and we'll move straight to questions. And as usual, I'll maybe begin with a sort of general opening question. So by way of sort of setting the scene, the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act of 2018 aims to improve the criminal justice system's ability to tackle domestic abuse effectively and increase court's capacity to protect victims. And the Act created a new offence of domestic abuse against a partner or ex-partner, and the aim was to help enable effective prosecution of behaviour that was taking place over a period of time, which is physical and or psychological abuse. And we know that the Scottish Government's recent report on the Act states that at that point there were 420 people prosecuted in 2021 to 22 using the new offence. So perhaps reflecting a sort of slow burn, so to speak. So I wonder if I can maybe just ask each of you, reflecting on the first year of the Act being enforced, just for your individual perspectives, and if you can perhaps give a broad opening comment on the success or otherwise of the new legislation. So I'll maybe come to Dr. Houghton first, and then I'll bring in Michelle Burnman, and we'll start with you both. So Dr. Houghton.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me today. So after reviewing 22 closed cases alongside victims and child witnesses, I would say that the definition within the Act that you mentioned, the huge shift to recognise psychological abuse and ongoing abuse over time, certainly reflects their experiences, which was one of the main aims of the Act. However, implementation of that definition is still a long way to go in terms of capturing psychological abuse, especially. Victims felt that wasn't represented fully in their case in terms of ongoing abuse rather than focus on specific physical incidents, even in out of the cases, even in the DASA cases, the ones that were under the Act, there was still felt to be a focus on two incidents or a small number of incidents rather than the whole story being captured. And lastly, one of the main issues for parents and child witnesses was that we attempted to capture the harm to children through the child aggravator and the NHOs covering children, and we have a long way to go in relation to that. I can speak more about that later.
Thanks very much. So I'll come to you now, Professor Burman, and then I'll bring in our other two witnesses. So over to you.
Yeah, thank you, and thank you for inviting me along here this morning. I think, Convener, at the beginning you talked about the slow burn and the relatively limited use of the legislation. And I think that whilst it's increasing, you know, slowly year on year, most charges of domestic abuse in Scotland continue to be under the Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Act. And I think that this really reflects the complexities of domestic abuse and the challenges of this posed by the legislation in determining a course of conduct. It does require a real quantum leap in thinking and in police investigation from moving from a very kind of traditional incident-focused approach to domestic abuse to understanding the course of conduct. So I think that's one of the reasons why there has been a very slow uptake of the legislation up until now, because it does require a different way of thinking. And drawing on some work that my colleagues and I at the University of Glasgow did on frontline policing of domestic abuse, just at the time that the legislation was introduced, when police were undergoing domestic abuse matters training and then undertaken a second sweep of interviews 2 years, just over 2 years later, you know, it's clear that the operation and the effectiveness of this legislation is dependent on policing interpretation and implementation, and the ability of the police to identify coercive controlling behaviour and elicit information on a series of abusive behaviours is absolutely crucial. And I think that we are still some way from the basis of our research of getting to that point where there is a recognition of sometimes the subtle and quite nuanced behaviours that that are sought through this legislation.
Thanks very much for that. I'm going to bring in Dr. Marcia Scott now, and then I'll bring in Amanda Masson. So, Dr. Scott, over to you.
Good morning, everybody. Happy International Women's Day, especially to the women in the room. More, what is it, a good cause mocks a strong arm. I wanted to, I'm possibly a little blunter than Michelle, but I totally agree with everything she and Claire said. There's an article published this morning by Andy Myhill from the College of Policing and colleagues around DASH risk assessments, which I think really supports what Michelle was saying. Although I don't think they're subtle and nuanced behaviors, I think they're actually very easy to see when people are properly trained. But I'll go back to the beginning. I think what we have seen with the implementation of the Act is a quite enthusiastic and positive embracing of it by the Crown Office and a real commitment to making it work. But they're just one piece of the puzzle. And I think that we have some really big tasks to do. And the implementation was always going to be a slow burn, if you will. I agree with that. But I think that it's not a slow burn in the sense that it's progress is guaranteed. And also, I'm sorry, but women and children can't wait for people to get around to figuring this out. We need to do it much more quickly than we have been. The point I think that illustrates this is that of all of the domestic abuse reports to the Crown Office, both in 2021 and 21-22, a really tiny percentage of them were processed, and these were domestic abuse reports, a tiny percent. So in 2021, it was 4.7, in 21-22, it was 5.5. Percentage of them were prosecuted under the Section 1 DASA in the DASA Act. And I think we are absolutely confident that that is quite an under identification of DASA cases. And I think, you know, I think what the Crown Office fiscals would say to us, we can only prosecute with the evidence we've got. And I'm somewhat sympathetic for that. But they often the police will get them the evidence if they're asked for it. So I think that across the whole piece, there is work to do on implementation, but the most critical, and I agree with Michelle, the most critical place is with evidence gathering and the frontline policing. And the thematic inspection of the police really confirmed our concerns about the understanding of gender and coercive and controlling behaviors by police, some of whom are excellent, really excellent, and I want to underscore that. However, the inspection and Andy Myhill's research and everything that survivors have been telling us is that it's a lottery, a postcode lottery about whether the police officer who a woman and or a child talks to understands coercive and controlling behaviors. This is really important because coercive and controlling behaviors are one of the single biggest indicators of lethality in domestic abuse cases. So it's not about, oh, this is a lower threshold of risk. This is the highest threshold of risk. I have lots to say about other things and COVID and the response under COVID, but I probably will just draw a line under there because I suspect you would like me to.
Thanks very, very much. A comprehensive response, as always. Thank you. So I'm now bringing Amanda Masson, and then I will open up to other members for more questions. Amanda.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you very much for inviting me to participate. I would just like to sort of endorse what my colleagues have said so far this morning, but offering a perspective from the solicitor's standpoint, my sense is that whilst there's certainly much greater understanding of what coercive control means, there is still a reluctance on the part of clients who might consult me in a family law capacity to accept that this is something that's happening to them. It may well be that there is still a reluctance to accept that behaviour is not necessarily violent, to be coercive, to be controlling, to be abusive. I suspect there is also still a perception that domestic abuse is something that doesn't necessarily affect certain socioeconomic groups. And from my perspective, there is certainly a lack of understanding of how these behaviours can affect children. Certainly in my child welfare report practice for the court, there's very, very little said about the effect that witnessing behaviours can have on children. And my sense is that when it comes to the MARAC assessments, there's very, very little being said about coercive control. The focus is still very much on, I suppose, the more, for want of a better word, conventional assessments involving physical violence. From my perspective, it's the public perception really that needs to change. It's about raising awareness of new of what coercive control means.
Okay, thanks very much, Amanda. A number of really interesting and relevant points made there, and I know the comments made about the policing response, and we will be hearing from Police Scotland in our next panel. So I'll now open it up to members. I've got a few members wanting to come in. I'm going to start with Pauline McNeill and then Colette Stevenson.
Pauline. Thank you very much, and I'd like to also say Happy International Women's Day as well on record. So we've read from the papers, and I wasn't involved at the time, but I'm fully aware of the significance of the legislation that Scotland passed, identified as world leading. So we're proud of that aspect of it. So I'm not really familiar with the detail. So this is what I want to sort of get into. How can we then fix what I suppose Amanda finished off by saying, which is you've got people, clients reluctant to even raise the question, and we've got the issues I imagine, which is what I want to get into, how are we going to do better at creating the understanding and proving these cases in court? I mean, I guess when we pass the legislation, as legislators, we do this. We think this is what we'd like. And then the agencies then have to then work out the practicalities on the ground. So I am sympathetic, I have to say, to Police Scotland in that regard. I don't know what guidance they were given. I don't know what the Act says in terms of when they see something that might be regarded as coercive behaviour, psychological damage to a woman or indeed a man. What should they be looking for? Is the Act clear? That's my first question. Is the Act clear about what needs to be shown? And then, of course, the police will hand that over to the Crown Office for final decision on that. So anything that the witnesses could tell me, what they think, is the Act clear enough? And if it's not, what do we need to do to provide the relevant evidence or understanding of those provisions? I think I wouldn't mind a comment from everyone, if that's okay.
Yeah,
Claire,
could we bring in Claire first?
Yeah, absolutely. You reminded me, Ms McNeill, of one of the victims we interviewed and an example of really good practice. And this is a woman who said, I just went in and told what was going on. I was really just saying how frightened I was because of the baby and the behaviour and how confused. So I did go right back to them with them. And this was first of all a health work and then the police to the very beginning. And lots of pieces of the jigsaw came together. So the Act itself, the detail of the Act talks, especially when we're talking about the relevant effects in relation to fear, alarm and distress, talks about monitoring, controlling, surveillance, being in fear, as well as adverse effects on children, which we'll come back to later. So there is a lot of detail, but also it is what then can evidence that is quite tricky. And I would say it's not necessarily a reluctance on the victim survivor's part, but sometimes they do need support in identifying that it's a criminal course of behaviour, and they felt that they didn't know, but also that some people, unlike the police officer and health worker here, didn't know the details of the Act, like, and therefore they couldn't apply it to that case, and they would just look at more physical abuse and physical harm, the more conventional, as Amanda said, kind of evidence. So other victims' spouses were very clear that they were being psychologically harmed and surveilled, being tracked to work, things like that, and felt they had lots of evidence in their view, such as printing out lots of emails or showing lots of texts, lots of online abuse, but then they felt that that wasn't taken fully on board, and that only a small piece of their jigsaw was actually revealed in court. So when they tried to build their own case, and they did want to collaborate more with the police and the Procurator Fiscal in terms of their case, they still felt that psychological abuse, the non-physical harm, which was the kind of groundbreaking part of this Act, was hard both to speak about, like to talk about manipulations, really difficult things like that, but also then to evidence. The details are there up to a point, but then how do we evidence that? How do the police officers support a victim to speak about abuse over years as well, which is quite a skilled level mm-hmm. of approach, I think.
I absolutely agree with what Claire has just said there. I mean, I think that the legislation is clear. There is clarity in the legislation about what is sought, but it's about the implementation and application of that legislation and evidencing things like emotional abuse, psychological abuse can be very, very difficult to do. I think it comes back to this, the interaction between the police and the survivor in order at that particular time, in order to determine the kind of wider context, how the different incidents might be linked, how the history might be linked. So it does rely on a particular kind of development of a different sort of relationship, if you like, between the police and the survivor in order to elicit that information and in order to support the survivor to be able to feel that she, because it's usually she, can talk about that gain the trust of the survivor to be able to speak about that. So, you know, for me, it does come back to the implementation of the legislation and the degree to which the police are equipped to interpret and implement that legislation at that point of discussion. And just one thing is that in Scotland, usually it's tier one response officers who are called out. We have three tiers of response in relation to domestic abuse, and it's usually the tier one who go out onto the scene. They're not specialist officers like tier two and tier three police officers. As officers in our research have told us, tier one response officers are slaves to the radio. This means that they may have umpteen different calls in the course of one shift. Investigating domestic abuse cases, they can be complex, they require longer time, they can be quite protracted and quite lengthy because of the detail and the nuance that needs to be determined. And often that poses a challenge to the first response tier one officers who have got other calls coming in that they need to go to in a resource-constrained environment and a lot of paperwork to do. And so I think there is an issue there about the reliance on the tier one frontline response officers at that point, and that's where I see that there is room for more training, more trauma-informed practice training, and more training around, specialised training around the legislation itself at that point, because that's often the first and the most important interaction.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I think both our witnesses online would like to come in, so I'll bring in Marcia first and then Amanda, and if I can just ask for fairly succinct answers, just so that everybody gets an opportunity to come in with questions.
You know, that's not my best thing, but I will be very succinct here. I actually think the law is fine. I think the law, in part because survivors contributed so much of the language, especially in the guidance, about freedom and autonomy and fear and distress. So I think that language is fine around what does coercive control look like and feel like. And I agree with what was said before, so I won't repeat it. But the other area, and I think Claire would back me up on this, that the law needs work, I think, on is children. We failed to get the language in the bill to designate children as co-victims if there was a conviction of one of their parents, obviously, usually their mother, their father. We're really concerned that the aggravator, even if it were applied in all of the cases in which it could be, which we can't get that data because the Crown Office doesn't collect data in a way that we can, would do the trick. And it's really clear to us from multiple sources of evidence that civil cases that follow criminal cases of domestic abuse are not reflecting our much broader understanding now of the impact and harm and trauma that domestic abuse visits on children. And we were unhappy at the time that the bill was passed that this was true. And I really think this is an issue that is really critical to be taken up possibly in an amendment process.
OK, thanks very much, Marcia. And I'll bring in Amanda.
Thank you. I think the law is absolutely fine. I really do. From a practitioner's perspective, it's well drafted. It's clear. I don't think it could be clearer. Clients certainly understand what it means, and I think that's the important thing. I would agree with other comments, though the issue is with the implementation and the gathering of evidence.
Can I just have one quick follow-up? I'll make it quick to Amanda. Thanks for all these answers. What I'd like to follow up on is, so the law is clear, and I think Michelle made a really important point about who's going out to visit when a crime is reported. So I'm wondering at what stage then in the process you would start to gather the relevant information to show that coercive behaviour was being committed. And I wondered, maybe is it more practical that the initial reports done by the police on someone in between then needs to look at, because I imagine you need to gather or you'll fail in court, because at the end of the day, you know, the person is still, the accused is still not convicted until you prove the crime against them, and that has to be substantial. So I'm just wondering where in the process would make sense then to gather the relevant evidence about fear and alarm over a long period of time, or I presume that's what you're looking for, and that someone is not free to make decisions in the relationship, and all of these things need to be proved. Where do you think in the process it would make sense for someone to gather that information for the court?
Amanda, would you like to come in?
Yes, I can think of three private cases I've had in the last year where it's been clear to me there's been an issue of coercive control. The evidence has come from friends and family. Now, how practically this could be done, I'm not entirely sure, but I wonder if when police, who ideally would be specialist responders, are first faced with these reports, should they be saying to survivors, give me the names of your sister, your friend, your colleague who you've talked to about this? And that could help create the body of evidence that's needed. Because in those three cases that I can think of, what has happened is that the survivors have simply said, I want out of this relationship, help me get divorced. And for them, that's how they get out of it. But often reports have been made to the police, but there's been that lack of corroboration. So I think the time to gather the evidence would really be shortly after the first approach is made to Police Scotland.
Thank you very much.
OK, thanks very much. OK, I'll bring in Colette Stevenson and then I'll bring in Rona Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, and happy International Day to everyone as well. Women's Day, sorry. I just wanted to ask about the impact that the Act has had on the consideration of victim safety where an offender is actually sentenced, including through the non-harassment orders as well, or the use of them. And the other thing as well, from the wealth of evidence that's been taken, as how it's the NHOs haven't actually been extended, where they've been used, sorry, they haven't been extended down to the children and the impact that that has had as well in terms of coercive control. And if I put that to Marcia first, thanks.
Absolutely. And I think the the issues with NHOs covering children goes back to what we were saying, what I was saying before about people not really understanding, courts not understanding the impact of domestic abuse on children, and thinking that that there's some threshold of harm that they can identify. I also think that difficulty with the system is that we're improving the front end of it, and the policing is a problem, and everybody's identified that. And the DASH risk assessment research that I was referring to before about the previous question, there's lots of evidence about, and that should be done in every frontline tier one police visit to in a domestic abuse case. The research is telling us that the way officers use it is often unfortunate and minimizes and discounts evidence around coercive control. That's a separate issue. But in terms of what happens in court and sentencing when there's a conviction, we hear so many stories from women that essentially the vast majority of sentences are community sanction or community disposals, and there is no evidence in Scotland that has a protective effect for women and children. Forget about the rehabilitation supposed aspects, and nobody really wants to open this really difficult box. I would ask that somewhere someone has the appetite to say, well, where is the evidence that community disposals encourage convicted offenders to desist in their offending? Do women and children feel safer? No. I mean, there's a whole lot of problems with it. And thank goodness for the NHO element in the new act. If it were used more consistently, then it would actually provide more protection. We do hear pretty consistently from women and children that it's that element that provides them some breathing space, that makes them feel safe. Not all perpetrators will pay attention, but the majority will. And when they do, there is a demonstrable improvement in how people feel about the application of the law. There's been a whole lot of issues with breaches of conditions that haven't been responded to appropriately. COVID exacerbated that terribly. But in the grand scheme of things, sentencing is the elephant in the room as far as we're concerned.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask Amanda now?
Yeah, I would agree with everything that Marcia has said. For me, children are really missing in this process, and I think that's partly because we worry about children giving evidence. It's almost an instinctive thing. You know, we don't want to interview children, we don't want to talk to them, we don't want to place them under the pressure, perhaps, of perceiving that they're talking against our parent. When I talk to children in a slightly different context, in the separation context, they often have lots to say. They say it clearly, they say it well. There's more that can be done. Children's First are currently doing really, really good work in relation to safe places for children to give evidence. And it might be useful for that work to be linked in with what the Justice Committee are looking at. Because for me, that's the key to involving children in giving evidence, making it safe for them to do so, and again, changing that perception of their role. Because yes, of course, we want to protect them, but they might well be key to providing the evidence we need in these types of cases, if their evidence can be taken safely and comfortably for them.
Okay, thanks, okay. Amanda. Okay. If I pass it on to Michelle.
Yeah, I think, well, first of all, I want to say that it's erroneous to think that abuse will stop once the perpetrator has left the family home, because physical abuse may stop, but there are other forms of abuse, particularly emotional and psychological and financial abuse. And often child contact or child custody is an arena in which that abuse can continue. I mean, I think really what is very important is a proper, adequate risk assessment to ensure sufficient safety planning around the non-abusive parent and the child. And I think we have yet to see that robust safety planning here in Scotland. It's not as developed or as foregrounded as it is in other jurisdictions. On the question of non-harassment orders, I mean, I think that signposting to the civil justice process for NHOs is not an effective means of identifying risk, especially given the legal aid crisis impacts. I think that needs to be done and determined at the criminal court. And finally, I would just say that when there is a civil case that carries on, that is subsequent to a criminal justice case involving domestic abuse, there is no mechanism for information about domestic abuse feeding into that civil justice process. This is entirely up to the parties to inform the lawyers that there is a background of domestic abuse. It's serendipitous the way in which that information is fed from one system through to another, and I think that is problematic.
Okay, thank you. And Claire?
I agree with that. So I'll just take a slightly different tack. I've researched with children now for 30 years on domestic abuse, and they do want to be heard and to have a say. Some want to be witnesses, but I agree with Amanda, in a safe place and quickly. Hence the moves to pre-recorded evidence and Barner House. But we need to think of that kind of approach in terms of both the adult and child victims, this pre-recorded, safe, quick giving of evidence, so we don't have the delays that we have just now. I know exacerbated through COVID, but they were there already. Mm-hmm. And the trauma that victims are experiencing, both adult and child, for lengthy delays, adjournments, and also when they come to give evidence and there is a late plea of guilty and they're actually, for example, a child outside in the car with a support worker crying and nervous about giving evidence but ready, but then there's a plea of guilty. And we heard that again and again and again. There were 10 child-sighted witnesses, though, saying that. There were 10 child-sighted witnesses in the cases that we talked about, but only one child aggravator and only three NHOs involved children. So we have still got an issue even when we are trying to hear children. And all of the victims and witnesses talked about the sentence not in any way capturing the full story of their abuse, but nor the severity and course of behaviour. And in terms of NHOs, because we only looked at closed cases, which was our remit, some of the victims were coming to the end of their NHOs, like mm-hmm. 1 or 2 years NHOs. So the length of NHOs is a real issue. And also we kept being asked, how do we lengthen this without recourse to civil law? And that didn't seem an easy way either. They were absolutely in fear and they hadn't received the mental health and trauma support they needed in that whole of 2 years.
Can I quickly just come back in on what you said there, Claire? The impact from the evidence that you took, has there, in terms of NHOs being lifted as well, have you seen a dramatic effect of that?
Because there were so few closed cases, that they were at the point of being lifted. So all I can say is that the utter fear and how frightened some of the victims were. So they were already seeking their own redress, talking to the Scottish Women's Rights Centre. The man was talking to a civil lawyer like Amanda. So they're trying to find different ways to protect themselves. And several, at least five, were talking about moving. After 2 years, after the NHOs, not after the court case, not immediately after the abuse, but because the NHOs were about to expire, they were talking about moving country, moving like hundreds of miles to try and feel safe. One victim in there talks about not being able to go out without her son, her adult son, there to protect her. So there was real issues about ongoing NHOs. And I know there are some lengthier NHOs that have been passed, which obviously offers more protection. And again, several of the victims were involved in separate cases about breaches of NHOs already. Yeah. And because they weren't closed, we couldn't speak to them about that, but they were very much sceptical about them being taken seriously, which is one facet of the new Act.
Okay, thank you. Okay. No further questions?
Yeah. Okay, thanks very much. I'll bring in Rona Mackay and then Russell Finlay.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to start with Michelle, please. I was interested in what you said about you know, abuse not stopping when NHOs were issued, etc., etc. You'll be aware that in the last session we passed legislation for domestic abuse protection orders domestic abuse protection notices. This hasn't started to be used yet, so I'll be interested to ask the police about that. It was good legislation generally, and it also links in with something I was proposing, or am proposing, as a member's bill, which has been put on ice, and that's stalking protection orders, where the police can go directly to court and ask for a protection order for the complainer. I just wanted to get your opinion on how relevant that legislation that we passed was, where the alleged perpetrator would be removed from the house.
I do think that is a very welcome development, and I think that it will make a difference in some cases. But perpetrators can be very inventive in the way in which they are used, particularly digital means, increasingly, to continue or restart the abuse, even when they are some distance away, even when, you know, the family have moved to flee. There is still ways in which perpetrators can continue and restart the abuse. So, you know, I think it's a very positive step, but I think we have to be realistic about the inventiveness.
Thank you. And I was interested in what you were saying about the tier one responders and how that, you know, they were so caught up with calls they probably didn't have the time to spend. Do you think it's an argument to have specialist domestic abuse police officers?
I do. Mm-hmm. I think that there should be enhanced specialist training, probably for all police officers, given the volume of domestic abuse and the likelihood of different officers being called out. But I think we already have specialist officers, you know, at tier two and tier three, you know, at the divisional level and also at the national level with the task force. Mm-hmm. I think it's the issue with the tier one police officers from our research is the time available that they have to spend at that mm-hmm. point when they are, as I said, slaves to the radio, when they're being called off on the course of a shift to a range of other different things. Yeah. And I think we need to see this within the sort of resource-constrained context of criminal justice generally and policing within that. Okay. I think more time and more enhanced specialist training that is trauma-informed training. I mean, you know, I think that's very important. Yeah. And we have had the domestic abuse matters rolled out, a wonderful feat with, you know, many thousands of police officers undergoing that training, but it needs to be continued and reviewed. One-off training is not as effective as if it's constant and, you know, at regular interviews.
Okay, thank you. If I could direct my next question to Amanda, please. And it's about, I guess it's about victim awareness. We talked about that. I don't know if... sorry.
I wonder if I can just come in. I'm aware that Marcia Scott wanted to come in.
Oh, sorry,
on that.
Beg your pardon. I didn't notice that.
First question. Yeah, sure. So, Marcia, do you want to come in? And then, Rona, you can move on.
Just to comment on the Domestic Abuse Protection Scotland legislation, I know I won't be in the next panel, I know Sam Falls will be. I know the police have really big concerns about implementation of the law. We've been involved in multiple meetings and conversations about the problems of implementation, and I think I would just like to say for the next panel discussion, that our perspective is that there may well be problems. We're very happy to talk about solutions, but the reality is that we can't pause until and somehow think that harm is not happening as we speak. The other issue is that we have a commitment under Istanbul, which has now been ratified by the UK government, to have emergency barring orders in place. Scotland does not and has not ever had those that would comply with the Istanbul Convention. We are unlike many, many European countries. This cannot be an unsolvable problem. Other people are doing it and have been for decades. So can we stop pointing fingers about how much it's going to cost and start figuring out how to implement it? I just need to say that. The other issue for us is there needs to be protection all along the system. So from the first time that a woman discloses, and that's unlikely to be to police. We all know what the figures are. And the reasons for that are not because she hasn't identified that she doesn't like what's going on or that she isn't afraid. It's that her experience tells her that her experience will be minimized, her harm will be downgraded, you know, and if it's not a physical assault, it's a lottery about whether somebody's going to take her seriously or not. I don't think we need specialist police officers at the front line. Well, I would love to have them. 25% of police business is domestic abuse. So I'm kind of with Michelle on that. Like, they all need to be specialists in this. But there is evidence from the research of the College of Policing that this can be done much better. We just need to invest in appropriate training and follow-up and implementation infrastructure. Absolutely right that one-off trainings don't work. We said that at the time. Just saying. But I do think it's not rocket science. It isn't this big, terrible thing that we can't figure out. We just need to do it right.
Thank you. Thank you. Just while Marcia's there, can I just ask her something relating, she said, and it relates to the Istanbul Convention, and it's about no recourse to public funds, Dr. Scott, which I know Women's Aid have been doing a lot of work on, meaning that when asylum seekers or immigrant women come and live in Scotland and are fleeing domestic abuse, they have no recourse to benefits. Is that something that you think? I mean, I appreciate this is a reserve matter to Westminster, but you know, is there more we could be doing in Scotland about that?
Well, as a matter of fact, there is. I think the COVID emergency let us think about what tools might be available. So when we have a public health emergency, which I think domestic abuse is. We were allowed to house women and children instead of making them destitute. Istanbul is really clear that your access to support and safety should not be mediated by whether, you know, by your immigration status. I think it's really clear, to be fair to Scottish government officials, that they would like to be able to provide more support than they feel like they can under the Scotland Act. I do think that there is room to explore across. There's cross-party consensus on this, I think, in Scotland, or most parties anyway. And so there's the Scottish government is committed to coming up with housing pathways, human rights-based housing pathways for women and children experiencing domestic abuse, because domestic abuse is the single biggest driver of their homelessness. I think there's lots of good intentions, but there hasn't been very much practical response. And the other thing that I really would like to say, and it's really mundane, but data. There's such a failure of our system to understand that it needs to collect competently collected intersectional data. So it is very difficult for us right now to be able to even identify the number of women with no recourse in Scotland and how to model what what supporting them would cost. I'll stop, I promise. But the Domestic Abuse Commissioner in England and Wales has just published a report about a cost-benefit analysis about extending the domestic abuse exception that would go a long way to helping women and children in Scotland.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Could I ask Amanda a question, if that's okay? Amanda, I would like to ask you about victim impact statements. And I understand that before sentencing in a court, this domestic abuse does not come into the list of crimes that is eligible for victims to give statements. Maybe Claire wants to come in too. I think that's a huge omission, and I just would like your view on that.
I would agree. I think victim impact statements would go a long way to helping survivors feel heard. I think it would help to raise public awareness of the issues and how being on the receiving end of certain courses of conduct can make people feel. So I think the benefit would be twofold, as well as the sort of conventional benefit of hopefully helping during the sentencing process. For me personally, I think that the huge positive to be coming from that would really be that people would have an opportunity to say how they felt and be heard. But in turn, I would expect that would help raise public awareness of what constitutes a course of conduct. And people may well, you know, hear these reported on the media and think, actually, get it now. That is something that I've experienced and it's not okay. Just while I was listening to Marcia there, I was thinking about an email I received yesterday from a client. And, you know, I can't obviously say too much, but she was saying to me, I told my husband I was frightened. I told him that's why I had to leave the house. He thinks I'm having an affair. What can I do? And she's coming to a family lawyer. She's coming to a divorce lawyer before she goes to the police. And during the dialogue about, you know, what she intended to do, did she have someone to talk to? Did she have support? Her response was, the police won't take this seriously. So for me, there's still an issue there around public perception of what the police think constitutes abusive behaviour and how seriously the police would take it. So it's maybe public awareness. I remember when the legislation came in, there was a really, really good public awareness media campaign. And then things seemed to go quiet for a while. Mm-hmm. And it might well be that we just have to keep this in the public arena.
I would completely agree. And I don't know how many people have watched the excellent BBC series, The Women Who Changed Modern Scotland. And in that, there was a piece, I think it was in the 90s, Zero Tolerance did a fantastic awareness campaign. And, you know, it was just all over the place. And I had forgotten, but I do now remember it at the time. So I think, you know, and talking about the onus that's put on a woman to give to come up with the evidence, you know, I think an awareness campaign that could almost just tell people, you know, to keep a record of everything, you know, this is, you know, so that they're not caught and think, well, I don't know how to explain this, that kind of thing. So I think public awareness and victim awareness is absolutely huge. Can I just ask, Claire, I think you wanted to come in on the impact statement.
Just that was one of the recommendations from adults and children in terms of public messaging and clear messages from here, from the Parliament, from the Minister. Yeah. And I'd also say the public messaging around the Act, it wasn't sustained long enough, but also there was a promise of public messaging towards children and that didn't happen. So we need to really carefully think about that. But back to your victim impact statements, at the moment we're hearing that we're not finding the means for victims and children to tell their whole story in the investigation, in the case that's led at court. They don't feel it reflects their whole experience in the sentencing. And so, yeah, we need to look at victim impact statements at one of those routes as well as the others and make sure that when we're talking about victim impact, we're also talking about children.
Thank you very much.
We've got about 15 minutes or so left. I've still got some members wanting to come in. So I can maybe ask members if you would be able to target your questions at specific witnesses. And obviously others can come in if they wouldn't want to add anything further. And as ever, questions and answers, please, as succinct as possible. So I'll bring in Russell Finlay, followed by Jamie Green.
Thank you very much. This first question is for Dr. Houghton. I was really struck by the research you and Dr. Morrison and Dr. Warrington did that was published in January. You spoke to 22 victims of domestic crimes, and upon reading it, the key findings section, I think there were 10 key findings, and I think one of them is worth repeating in full just because it seems to encapsulate so much that's wrong, not just whether it be the police element, the prosecution element or the sentencing element, but all of it. And it says, participants had significant concerns that the investigation, prosecution and sentencing for domestic abuse offences did not adequately reflect the sustained level, severity or impact of abuse experienced. And that really, I suppose, sums it up. I suppose my question is, were you surprised by what you and your team found when speaking to these women? And have you had any feedback from the government, because they commissioned the work, whether that's from officials or ministers, And given that we've heard that it seems to be a consensus, there's not a legislative need to change anything necessarily, how we fix these embedded cultural problems within the system?
Thanks, Russell. Was I surprised? No, partly because previous research, for example, the Everyday Heroes research into children's priorities for justice, but also other research on gender-based violence, like Michelle Berman's Una's work on justice journeys for rape and sexual assault victims really reflected the findings of this research. Unfortunately, we also checked our findings because it is a 22 victim witnesses with court advocacy and support workers and Women's Aid, and they said this is reflective, unfortunately, of the experience of especially women and children. I did still find it unremittingly grim, yes. And we, in the advisory group, which is full of allies such as Police Scotland, Crown and our lead NGOs, were certainly determined not just to get feedback, but to work with the government to improve the response. And I think we need to look at now, how do we do that? Have we got an implementation group? How are we monitoring this? How are we getting the data about that's missing, for example, associated children in these cases? And we do also need to examine whether there is or isn't a legislative need in terms of children, and have a much closer look at child aggravator use, and also, but not only child aggravator, but any associated children, with that children that have been harmed and impacted by domestic abuse. But yeah, it was certainly a very difficult and research project to be part of, but an immense privilege that these women and children spoke at length about their experience, partly because they felt they hadn't had that opportunity in court. Thank you.
Thank you. I was, just for what it's worth, I was in contact with one of the participants, and she's very grateful for not just the opportunity, but the subsequent support that she's received from you and your team. So,
Thank you. Great. Thanks
I've got one more question, if that's okay, and it's probably directed to Professor Berman. I think in some of the earlier evidence you talked about civil cases and criminal cases sometimes running in tandem, albeit completely disconnected. I'm familiar with cases of that nature where an abuser has used the criminal courts as a means of extending the abuse, prolonging the abuse, using that to almost delay or derail the criminal prosecution and vice versa. Mm-hmm. And I just wonder if there's been any research done into that specific problem, and also whether anyone's given consideration that you know of into a fairly radical fix of perhaps combining criminal and civil matters relating to the same parties, or is that just a little bit getting ahead of the game?
Right. In relation to your first question, there has been no research in Scotland that's looked at the way in which a perpetrator might manipulate criminal and civil justice proceedings. There has been research undertaken in England and Wales by Maddie Coy and her colleagues, but that's focused from the perspective of the non-abusive parent, if you like, but we haven't had anything like that in Scotland. Our research on child contact in cases in the context of domestic abuse that was recently published in December found that, that was happening, but that was through the perspective of family lawyers rather than through the perpetrators or the non-abusive parents themselves. So there is some evidence of that, but we haven't had a clear focused piece of research in Scotland on that as yet. In terms of combining the two, well, I'm looking at Amanda here. I don't know how feasible that would be. What I do think is that we need to have better mechanisms for communication and information sharing between the criminal and the civil justice systems. We, as I said earlier, it's really only a matter of chance or luck that the civil courts hear about, the background of domestic abuse. So we need better communication. We need mechanisms whereby relevant professionals in those systems are tasked with providing that information because it's important. And one, you know, that it's important that civil justice knows what's happened in the criminal proceedings, that there has been a case in the criminal courts in relation to domestic abuse. And at the moment, we don't have that at all.
Yeah. I'm dealing with cases now in which a woman whose partner is seeking legal aid for civil action to, she believes the ultimate goal is to remove the child from the UK.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
There are parallel criminal proceedings.
Yeah.
And I've made representation to SLAB, Legal Aid Board, to try and point out the background to this.
Mm-hmm.
But she feels totally isolated and feels that the system is against her and is facilitating what's going on. You know, so I suppose that speaks to that.
Yeah, I think those cases of legal system abuse, you might call it, are very prevalent. And we've heard lots of stories of that in our research in this area.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you. I think before we move on, I think Amanda and Marcia are wanting to come in. So bring Amanda first, then Marcia, as briefly as you can. Thank you.
Just briefly, yes, I agree. The mechanisms for information sharing are poor. I don't think it's too big an ask to try to amalgamate the civil and the criminal. From my perspective, I'm afraid I feel obliged to say the legal aid crisis is having a terrible impact. I have not in my 20 years of practice ever known a letter of objection to the Civil Legal Aid Board to result in the outcome that I think your constituent is hoping for. Now, I can speculate about the reasons for that, but the way to fix this, in my view, is just to have a better overview, more communication between different agencies, and to be aware of the what's just been described as the legal system abuse. Solicitors obviously represent their clients. That's our professional duty. But I think we also have a duty to recognise where information sharing might have a wider interest, particularly the interests of the children, duties to the court. My practice is increasingly around children who are becoming victims of coercive control via contact actions. And that's quite a bold statement to make. It's something I'm very sad to have to say, but it's something that I am seeing happen more and more often. It's very easy to secure legal aid for child contact disputes, but those disputes are not always necessarily being processed quickly enough to take into account the risk of abuse.
Thank you.
Okay. And Marcia, very briefly.
Just to respond to the question about what should be done if it's not legislative. Russell, I think it was your question. We've suggest that an implementation, Domestic Abuse Scotland Act implementation group be reinitiated. We were not invited to sit on the first one. That was only statutory partners, but we think we could have improved it, and we would like to see that happen again to look at the landscape and make a plan. Secondly, really quickly, around information from criminal and to civil cases, at the time of the crafting of the domestic abuse legislation, we brought evidence from a Supreme Court in New York judge who had done a lot of work on this, and he suggests one judge or sheriff in Scotland's case, one case. Which would ensure that there was information that traveled automatically, obviously, in the brain of the sheriff from the criminal case to the civil case. I checked with a number of sheriffs and judges in Scotland. They thought there was much to recommend that model, but there doesn't seem to have been any appetite on the part of leaders to take that up. I don't think it's too little to ask, frankly. And I'll stop there.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, Jamie Green, and then I'll bring in Fulton McGregor. Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to our guests. Can I start with Dr. Scott? And at the risk of opening up a Pandora's box with this question, but I'm going to ask it anyway. You made a comment, slightly off-the-cuff comment earlier in the session, about the elephant in the room. I'd like you to elaborate on that, because I think it's very relevant to the conversation, and I think that's specifically around the issue of sentencing as a deterrent. Could you just briefly share your thoughts on that?
I can be brief on this. We have long said that we didn't think community payback orders or community sanctions were effective. And what would we don't, you know, we're not suggesting that everybody get thrown in jail and left there forever. What we are suggesting is that look at more effective sanctioning, and that would probably require a significant expansion of the use of electronic monitoring, you know, other kinds of mechanisms, more custodial sentences perhaps, but you know, because we don't want to throw more people in jail, which I totally support in other cases, you know, who's carrying the risk here? It's the women and children experiencing domestic abuse. So we need to be willing to talk about alternative sanctions.
Okay. So, I mean, on that, you'll be aware of the report that was produced this week by this committee on proposals to bail and release. And I think you spoke earlier about the volume of offenders breaching their bail conditions and the effect that that has on their victims. Have you had a chance to have any initial review of our in-depth report and our recommendations, or anything you wanted to comment on now in relation to that and with respect to domestic abuse?
We submitted a significant consultation response in response to the bail bill. But weren't invited to provide evidence. So I would have been happy to do that. No, I haven't had a chance to read your report yet, but I would be happy to come back to you on it.
Okay, we look forward to that. I wanted to pick up other issues which haven't been touched on because we've covered quite a lot of ground already. One was first of all, is the issue of regional disparity and the prevalence of domestic abuse in Scotland. I know from our papers that areas such as Dundee, Western Bartonshire and Glasgow City have a much higher rate per 10,000 of the population than other parts of the country. And I just wondered what you think more could be done in terms of either education, policing, or, you know, where are the problems lying? And that may be even a question for our academic friends in the room, because I'm slightly concerned it does affect disproportionately the West of Scotland, which is an area I represent, and why there is such this regional disparity in this prevalence of domestic abuse cases. Maybe start with, Marcia, as soon as you're online, we'll come to you first, if that's all right.
Also, I have to go soon, so I'm okay. Really apologetic about that. But Edinburgh Women's Aid is celebrating International Women's Day and its 50th birthday, and I promised that I'd speak. It's really important not to take the prevalence data too seriously. It's really dodgy. We know that what it represents is police calls, and we know that most women don't call the police. So I would raise questions about whether we actually, what we do know is it's there's more police activity in those communities. And my analysis of that is that women, poorer women, you know, women with a variety of reasons for why they do not have resources to get themselves and their children safer, more likely to be involved in the system and to call the police. And I think if you look at the poverty rates in those areas, and then you look at the prevalence rates of, well, they're not prevalence rates, but reporting rates to police of domestic abuse cases, I suspect you will see quite an interesting correlation.
Thank you, Dr. Scott, and I should add my congratulations on your organisation's birthday, and also as one of the minority token men on the committee, happy International Women's Day to you, Dr. Scott. In that case, I think you've raised a few fist pumps all the way. I think you've raised a few interesting points there. I probably won't labour that because we haven't got time, so therefore I won't come to our panel on that issue. And the last point I did want to discuss, and it's probably bad timing because it is International Women's Day, is that domestic abuse also suffers men. There are male victims of domestic abuse, both at the hands of female and male abusers, and that's something that's I find it very hard to get statistical data on, actually, although I know HMI see who's in the next panel had some data on that, but I just wondered if there was a concerted campaign a couple of years ago, I think, in mixture between charities and the Scottish Government and some organisations in London to try and offer more support to deal with some of the stigma around, I guess, male domestic abuse. I wondered, you're nodding your head, Claire,
yeah,
I wonder if you might want to comment on that.
We interviewed just two male victims our research, so obviously can't generalise from that. Mm-hmm. But I would say that one male victim in particular felt that his gender did impact on response from services and from the police, particularly because it was a ongoing psychological abuse. He did feel a little like people thought he should man up, both his friends and family, but also the police response, but also that it wasn't taken seriously, even though it was a considerable amount of abuse over a long period of time. Mainly online, which is we've discussed, is really tricky in terms of evidence. But also, when he was asked, when does this become a crime, this ongoing psychological abuse, he was told it wouldn't become a crime. So this was really a difficult case. So I do think we need to look at that. And he was very aware that, very educated man, that the majority of victims were female, but he did feel that gender impacted on his response. The other male victim was quite different from a female partner, and again, we can't generalise from that. But what struck me was, despite the two occasions, according to the Act, and that was used in his case, he had wanted it dropped, and he wasn't in ongoing fear, alarm and distress, as all of the other, including the male, were. So we do have wider research and support services for male victims, but I also think we need to think about our messaging. I agree with you. I've had boys in the Everyday Heroes talk about not being believed when they've talked about rape or domestic abuse because it doesn't apply to them. So I do think it's an area worthy of consideration, as well as looking at the disparities across the country in terms of services for everybody, and particularly women and children. Court advocacy support came out as the most important service for everybody, including the men in this study, and yet the geographical disparities, and we're only looking at standardisation for adults and not children. So thanks for raising that.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Dr. Scott, I know that you have possibly to leave us, so please feel free just to log off when you need to. I'll now bring in Fulton McGregor and then Katie Clark. So, Fulton.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. It's been really quite interesting. I was one of the committee members in the last term who took this bill through along with Rona Mackay, and I think it's fair to say that when it was passed in the chamber, and other colleagues were here as well, it was one of the highlights of the previous session. And it's good now to be in a position to be doing the post-legislative scrutiny on it. I wanted to actually ask questions around an area which has had a wee bit of coverage. And Amanda, you raised it first, and it's about the information on the legislation for victims and the wider public as a whole. And I think often as parliamentarians, when we're taking the bill through, we kind of forget that. We're working on, no, we don't forget it, but we're working on more, how will the police implement it? How will social work services react to it? How will the third sector react? The courts, everything like that. But we sometimes forget, what is the public's perception of this? And you, I think, Amanda, you put it really well when you said that people would come to you and think, well, this isn't an offence, because I've not been physically assaulted or physically hurt. This is just, you know, this is the way he's always treated me, this sort of thing. I suppose my question then is, how can we make it more clear to the public that coercive control is an offence, what it is, and change the culture around that? And I'm not expecting this to happen overnight. I mean, it's clearly not happened even in the 4 years since the bill's been in, which isn't that long a period of time. But is there more we can do to speed up that process? Since I've mentioned you, Amanda, I can come to you first and then perhaps the other panellists.
It's a really difficult one, because my perception of this is that, yeah, I'm a family lawyer, so most of the people who talk to me about this behaviour have been in fairly long relationships. And as you say, this is just the norm. This is just how he or she has always been. But I think if we can continue the dialogue, that this behaviour does constitute a criminal. I do think public awareness are key, because I do remember really well and clearly that the last public awareness media campaign really did start conversations.
Amanda, we're having just a slight problem with your sound coming or going. I'll maybe suggest that we bring in another witness in the room, and then we'll maybe try and sort that out and come back to you.
I was involved in a public awareness campaign on domestic abuse with children, with the Voice Against Violence and the government, a joint campaign, and I felt that was a really effective campaign. It wasn't about the Act, and we haven't had one since the Act in relation to children, but there was a 200% increase in traffic to Childline that, whilst that was on. It was produced in... Well, they were part of the team, the media team, with the government, with the media people, and these young survivors, young experts in life, so I would really recommend that approach when we're talking about it, but it needs to be more than advertising. We need to look at education, look at schools, and just to say the victims and witnesses, even those who had DASA cases, didn't fully understand the Act. Back to Pauline's point earlier about do we know the detail and does everybody know that they didn't know that, and those that were subject to domestic abuse aggravated crimes, when they heard the detail of the Act, felt affronted that it wasn't applied in their cases and couldn't understand why. So yeah, I would support a wider public messaging. This is the key recommendation from the victim survivors, but only if a more robust response.
And just before I bring you in, Michelle, because just to save time, I suppose, based on the previous two answers, maybe when you're answering, you could think about this. Do you think if even one thing this committee could take away today from this session would be, and going back to the government, be about saying a public awareness?
Yeah, I do. I absolutely agree with what Amanda and Clara said. I think the public awareness and messaging is really very important, although one has to be quite careful with the nature of messaging because it can have a triggering effect for survivors. Mm. And we found that in the research that we did during COVID, where there was a lot of messaging around domestic abuse and coercive control, and the women that we spoke as part of our research found that to be very difficult and very triggering. So we have to be careful about that. But what I would say is that we need more radical reform. We can't simply rely on the criminal justice system to sort this out. This is a deeply entrenched problem. We need much more ambitious shifts across all of our public bodies. We need a coordinated and bespoke multi-agency response involving the police, involving the health, involving education, social services, and to develop an early intervention and public health-focused approach to domestic abuse. So I guess that would be my main message.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. I think, Amanda, there was nothing more that you were wanting to add to your previous response. So on that note, I'll just hand over finally to Katie Clark.
Yes, thank you. And it may be that the next panel might be better placed to answer this question. And I have been going through the papers to see if I could get the information I'm looking at. But really what I was interested in is specifically around about coercive control, to what extent that you've been able to get information on conviction rates and the difficulty in securing convictions. I know at the beginning of the evidence session there was, you know, a lot of discussion around about police interpretation and guidelines and whether we have case law to really evaluate how well the courts are able to, you know, decide on these cases. It may be that Claire might be best placed. I know you've done some research. I don't know to what extent you were able to look at that and how many, you know, cases you had to consider.
Yeah, thank you. I think the next panel will be better placed because I couldn't work out from the statistics where it was non-physical abuse only. But certainly the victim survivors felt that where it was mainly psychological abuse and for some the stalking and non-physical abuse only, that was even more difficult and more likely in their view to lead to minor sentences in their view, or actually the three non-guilty that we found. So, in their perspective, this was a lot more difficult. And the coercive control wasn't their parlance either. I know it's not used explicitly in our Act for many reasons, which is fine, but it's not part of how people are speaking. There was some mention of control, but psychological abuse and fear, alarm and distress certainly resonated. So it's just an interesting point compared to other laws in other countries that are coercive control only, which I think are limited compared to ours.
I don't know if any of the other panel members want to come back, but I'm quite happy to leave it there and to pick it up with the next panel, unless any of the witnesses had something that they felt would add, because I don't think we've got the data.
OK, thanks very much. I think we'll just pull things to a close on that note. Thank you very much indeed, panel members, for coming to join us today on International Women's Day. And we'll now have a short suspension just to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. So I welcome our second panel of witnesses this morning. So we have Craig Naylor, His Majesty's Inspector of Constabularies in Scotland, Detective Chief Superintendent Sam Falls, Head of Public Protection with the Specialist Crime Division of Police Scotland, and Moira Price, National Procurator Fiscal for Domestic Abuse and Head of Victims and Witnesses Policy Team at the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. So a very warm welcome to you all, and we'll just move straight to questions. And I'll come to Sam Falls and then Craig Naylor to begin with. We've heard in the first panel session this morning fairly extensive sort of commentary from witnesses regarding the key role of police officers in using the new legislation. And I can only appreciate just how big a change it will have been for police officers to use a different and quite novel piece of legislation, if you like. Now, we know that from the written evidence that was submitted that in terms of the training process for officers, there has been disruption around that arising from the COVID-19 pandemic and the potential sort of impact of that on, and I think it was referenced as the sort of confidence of police officers in using the legislation. So perhaps I can come to you first, Sam, just to ask a bit in and around what work is ongoing to address the training requirement and in the particular context of operational or divisional tier one officers who are at that front end of the policing response. So I'll bring in you first, Sam, and then Craig.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I think, so at the outset, when the legislation was implemented, we obviously undertook a real significant operation to train the numbers of officers that were trained at that point in time. We have retained the training licence for domestic abuse matters through the College of Policing, so that will continue and that is the plan. However, it would be remiss of me not to comment on the fact that we had COVID, we had the public health crisis where police officers remained frontline, and actually domestic abuse was one of the types of call where they always still got a face-to-face response. And we also had COP26 in Scotland. So over the last 2 years, there's been significant impact on training. We also recognise that we have had a number of officers who have left the organisation for various reasons, retirement, etc. And we've had a number of new recruits come in. So it's important then that we continue that training regime. But it has been significantly, and not just domestic abuse training, across a broad spectrum of, well, public protection is the one I'm usually fighting for, but it has been impacted across the board, and we're hoping now to start to pick that back up.
Mm-hmm. Thanks very much. Do you have timescales for that? Or, I mean, I know there are often unforeseen abstractions for, in particular, divisional officers, but in terms of timescales for training, can you maybe comment further on that?
So, some of that is still impacted upon by backlog of training that has to happen and to build cadres of specialist officers back up. We have a programme of refreshing training, more so for probationers, which is what our academic colleagues would refer to as the Tier 1 frontline response, and the new officers that have come through. So that gets picked up during probationer training. But the central team who review all of those training materials and products are currently looking at that to see how we can improve that. That's currently ongoing, but it's a rolling programme, and I don't have specific timescales for you.
Okay, thanks very much. Craig, I'll maybe just bring you in on the issue of training and, in particular, timescales, just from some of the work that you've already been doing around this.
Thanks, Convener. Yes, it was one of the recommendations we made in the report we published in January. We don't see it as a one-off event, and I think it was mentioned earlier that this has got to be something that is continuous, that is repeated on a regular basis, to update on things like new and emerging legislation and how that matters. things like stated case law, how are things changing, and how do officers become competent, maintain that competence, and go on to provide an excellent service. But there are challenges with that. You know, there are over 11,000 frontline officers in Police Scotland, and undertaking the domestic abuse matters training they did during the pandemic, I think, has been quite exceptional. But I think it's a good starting point. The bit for me is, so what next? And you know, the issues that Sam has mentioned about continuing that training, making sure that it's relevant to the officers, learning from the experiences from, you know, from our inspection, from the academic inspection work that's been done as well, to understand what a victim needs, mm-hmm. is absolutely where we need to be addressing the training. But we also need to address what the offender needs, and how do we more effectively address that offender's needs.
Thanks very much. I'm sure there will be some more questions around training from members later on. I wonder if I can come to you, Moira, just in probably ask much the same question around sort of the way in which understanding and knowledge of the new legislation is being developed within Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, in particular across your procurator fiscal body. So have there been challenges around that? And perhaps you can sort of comment on specifically training that's been delivered as well.
Thank you, Convener. CLPFS carried out significant training for not only our legal staff, but also our victim information and advice staff within the Prosecution Service in advance of the Act being implemented, so that staff were fully aware of the nature of the new legislation and how we would investigate and prosecute it, and so that staff had a very clear understanding of the type of evidence which would be required to be able to prove this new type of offence. The training comprised face-to-face training for all prosecutors, plus specifically designed e-learning for prosecutors. And new members of staff also undergo that training when they join COPFS. In addition to the training in relation to the DASA legislation, though, as an organisation, as a matter of routine, we provide accredited domestic abuse training to all members of legal staff who will be involved in the prosecution of domestic abuse and to victim and information staff. That includes, for legal staff, a 3.5-day training course on domestic abuse, which includes half a day spent with specialist support agencies who actually provide external support to victims of domestic abuse. So it is very extensive training. Craig mentioned the need for training to be updated as new case law is developed, and we have provided those updates to staff because in the last couple of years there have been significant cases and reports issued by the court, in particular the High Court, in relation to the application of DASA. So we've kept our legal staff updated on these cases as they are produced, in order that our staff have as full as possible an understanding of how to prosecute and the proper investigation required for offences under the new legislation.
Thanks very much. And just one final follow-up on that. I know that it's probably difficult for you to speak on behalf of other organisations within the court environment. Are you aware of any other training being delivered to, for example, defence solicitors via staff and so on?
I'm not aware of training for defence, but in relation to other organisations, the police and COPFS have worked together and provided mutual training mm-hmm. to each other. And in fact, the police participate in our our domestic abuse training to prosecutors. Mm-hmm. We are, however, both involved in the in provision of training about the criminal justice system to independent domestic abuse advocates.
Yeah. Thank you. That's helpful. Okay, I'm going to bring in other members now, and I'm going to hand over to Jamie Green and then Katie Clark.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning still. I note that some of you, or perhaps all of you, sat through the last session, so you will have heard some of the issues that were raised from the organisations which support victims of domestic abuse. I wanted to focus more on perhaps some of the procedural issues about how we get to from a point of someone reporting an incident through to a successful conviction and the pathway that that incident will take. The first is maybe an overarching question, and it's really just to get a feel for your view on this. But about 20 years ago, there were around 33,000 domestic abuse incidents reported to Police Scotland, given its nature at the time. So 20 years later, that number doubled to 65,000. And there has been a lot of conversation around whether that's good, bad or indifferent. There's obviously a school of thought that through a series of educated campaigns and public awareness and a shift in social concepts, that it's good news that people are more willing to come forward and report incidents, say, two decades ago. But equally, there could be a concern that there's an increase of incidents themselves, which is the issue I tried to raise with Dr. Scott. Do you have a view on that? Because there has been a trend and the number has been on the rise. There was a short decrease last year, 1%. But overall, especially over the last 7 to 8 years, it's been rising quite considerably. And that clearly is a concern to us as a committee and to those involved in this. Do you have a view on this? I'll just go along the panel.
All right.
Make life easy for you.
Okay.
My next question, I'll do it in the reverse order.
I think my view is probably based on 30 years in policing and having seen the changes in attitudes towards domestic abuse, mm-hmm. both within the police and within the communities that we work in. I see the increased reporting as a positive simply because I don't believe that it wasn't happening 20 years ago. I think it just wasn't recognised as abuse. It wasn't recognised as a criminal matter. And people didn't necessarily report it. It seemed to have been dealt with very much as a private issue. And also the police have become better at recognising it and at recording it, probably. So the increase for me is a positive, but I think it needs... This is a societal and generational cultural change that's going to take a long time, and the decrease might take a long time as well, if that mm-hmm. makes sense.
Mm-hmm. I hear what you're saying. The number's still quite high, though. I think it's just, even if it's an improvement on reporting, it's still a high figure.
A high figure, but I think that the academic research shows us that we have a huge number of individuals in Scotland who don't report it, so there's a lot of unreported abuse as well.
Yeah, which is also worrying. Mr. Naylor.
Thank you. It's a very good question, and I would echo Sam's points. Having lived through the last 35 years in policing, there has been a significant change in both the governance of how we record these matters, but also the encouragement of officers to treat them much more seriously than they were when I joined the police. When I joined the police, it was, if it happens behind a closed door in a private place, it wasn't really our business. Mm-hmm. Since 2007, 2008, when there was an HMICS report on this, there has been concerted efforts by policing in Scotland and Police Scotland to change that view, to change the view of every officer that serves, that a victim is a victim no matter where the crime occurs. And I think, as we say in our report, the progress has been quite remarkable. But I still think we're in a position where the majority of victims will not report it the first time that they become a victim. They won't report it the second time, and very often it'll be the fourth, fifth, maybe seventh time before they come forward and tell a family member, a friend, and eventually a police officer about this. So I think, as DCS Falls has said, this is vastly underreported. The fact that we have we've doubled the figures in 20 years, I think is indicative of the efforts that have been put in by Police Scotland to more accurately reflect what's going on mm-hmm. and address the problem. But we tend to focus very, very much on the victims, and that's as it should be. But we need to recognise who else is around them, the children in the family situation, other family members, but most importantly, the person who is causing the harm. And I don't think we focus enough in our society on the people that are causing this dreadful crime to people they allegedly love.
And as we move to the Crown's position on all of this, perhaps it would be a good point to look at the data. And I'm just going to cherry pick a year because it's recent, the year 20 to 21. Of the 65,000 cases, domestic abuse cases that were reported to the police. Under DASA, my understanding is that 1,600 crimes were recorded. I need to check, be careful my terminology here, because it's very easy to confuse statistics. 1,600 crimes recorded. Of those, 1,200 charges reported. Of those, as the convener said in her opening comments earlier, 420 individuals were there were proceedings against, and of those, 383 successful convictions. So I'm guessing I'm looking at the ratio of that. If you start with 65,000 incidents, and under DASA you have 383 convictions, whilst every one of them are very welcome convictions to the victims, it's 0.5% of the total. It doesn't seem great, and I know it's a journey, and I know it's a new piece of legislation, and the direction of travel seems to be okay over the last couple of years, but it still seems to be underwhelming. What's the Crown's role in all of this?
Firstly, I would say that I agree with both Sam Falls and Craig Naylor about the fact that the increase in reports hopefully reflects an increased confidence in victims and witnesses that if they do report domestic abuse, it will be taken seriously. When the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service receive reports of domestic abuse from the police, we will assess the evidence and we will assess whether it's appropriate to raise a prosecution in terms of the new DASA legislation or whether it's more appropriate to raise a prosecution under an existing common law or statutory offence with a domestic abuse aggravator attached. I think the fact that there is a relatively low number of domestic abuse offences recorded as reported in 2020-21 reflects the fact that this was new legislation, but more importantly, it's a course of behaviour offence. For a course of behaviour offence to take place, there has to be a start point, and it may take some time before there is sufficient evidence to establish a course of behaviour. And that may be reflected in the number of reports received over that period. Mm. However, what I would emphasise from the statistics for 2020-21 is that when these cases were reported, prosecutors took an initial decision to proceed to court in 92% of them. The principal reason why proceedings were not taken was due to insufficient available evidence, but that reflects the fact that prosecutors exercise proper professional judgment looking at the facts and circumstances of an individual case in determining whether there's sufficient evidence in law to proceed.
The dichotomy we have, though, is you know, we can analyse statistical data and you know, take a view on that. But equally as important, I guess, to us is the anecdotal evidence, and we've taken a lot of that. And I refer to a blog that Women's Aid recently penned, where they make it very clear that the survivors of domestic abuse have, and I quote, significant concerns that the investigation, prosecution and sentencing for domestic offences do not take into account the sustained levels of severity or the impact of the abuse or the experience. So it's very clear to a lot of us through casework that we do, through evidence that we take in private and in public, and through the organisations that work with these survivors, that so many people in Scotland still feel really let down by the whole system. And that's not to say anything disparaging about the officers who deal with the tier one reports, or the advocates who are then picking up the cases, or the judges who are facing the evidence before them, or indeed the juries if it comes to it. But clearly there still seems to be a whole system let down of so many where they're not being supported. How would you respond to that sort of criticism, if you like? And it is criticism. I'll go back the way then, however that.
I don't think it would be possible or appropriate for me to comment at all in relation to sentencing, which is a matter for the independent judiciary. What I can say, though, is that in relation to the investigation of domestic abuse, the police and fiscal service have established a very clear joint protocol to set the best standards of service to be provided in the investigation and prosecution of crime. That sets out very clearly the various avenues of inquiry which should be pursued and the information which prosecutors need to properly consider domestic abuse cases. And we work very closely with the police to make sure that we do receive the appropriate information that we need as prosecutors to take decisions in these cases. I would, though, emphasise that we need to consider each case on the basis of its own individual facts and circumstances. Mm-hmm. Again, we consider if there's sufficient evidence in law and public interest in prosecuting. We will apply a presumption in favour of prosecuting in all cases of domestic abuse, whether that be an offence under DASA or any of the other statutory or common law offences to which a domestic abuse aggravator can be added. So we do take a very proactive line in ensuring that we do raise domestic abuse prosecutions where that's possible based on the available evidence.
Mm-hmm. And as we go back down that line, unfortunately, I will add in the issue of sentencing, because Dr. Scott was quite clear with us that sentencing could be tougher. It's so very well passing it on to another element of the judiciary who's not here to defend themselves. But it's not just decisions by individual judges and sheriffs. We know that there's a sentencing council involved in all of this, and of course that is often underpinned by legislation itself, which does dictate the direction of travel. So perhaps you could, in your answer, also respond to that school of thought that really it's not proving to be a deterrent at all for some individuals.
I think I'd maybe turn it around in its head a bit, and I would echo the point that Moira made. I don't sit in the Sentencing Council, I don't have a view on that, and it would be inappropriate for me to take a view. But I think what we need to look at is that 65,000 victims have come forward, mm-hmm. and have trusted the services that they get. And some of the services they've got have been outstanding, and some have been much less so. And trying to fix those at the lower end of the service provision is where we need to focus on. So that a victim comes forward and can trust the police service to deliver a service to them, can trust the support mechanisms, can trust the fiscal service, mm-hmm. to get to a point where we get the best chance of not just a conviction, but allowing them to move on with their life in the way that they want to do so. And that's the really tricky bit here. You know, these are individual cases, 65 plus thousand of them, and it is very difficult to manoeuvre through their life and help them face the challenges they will face, whether that's financial, accommodation, caring for their children, caring for other people around them. That is a very tricky position while also trying to navigate a criminal justice process that is very adversarial, mm-hmm. and can be very daunting for a victim to come into contact with for probably the first time in their life. So the bit for me is, how do we support them through that process and get the outcome that they yep. deserve?
Especially if they've had the guts to come forward and pick up that phone, make that call to the police, possibly for the first time in years.
Absolutely.
And at the end of a torturous 3-year journey to find the perpetrator is given a community sentence or a fine. I mean, it is no wonder so many people feel let down by the system. I mean, is there a sense of palpable frustration in the police that you are seeing repeat offenders? You're coming out to households that your officers have been out to before, and that level of frustration that there's not enough being done to support those victims?
As my colleagues have said, it's probably not appropriate for me to comment on sentencing as such. But we do see repeat offenders. Domestic abuse is one of those crime types where the risk of recidivism is really high, and we recognise that, and we try to. That's why we proactively try to target individuals that we know mm-hmm. are repeat perpetrators. It would be wrong if I didn't recognise that we certainly don't always get it right, but we do work very closely with COPFIS to try and improve evidence gathering, sufficiency of evidence for police officers to report, and to improve the quality of reporting to the fiscal service to enable as informed a decision as possible for the part that we contribute to. But we also work with other statutory partners and third sector organisations, and we take victim feedback very seriously. We take academic research very seriously, and we try to learn from that. And we have a number of forums where victims and survivors groups can actually engage with us and give us feedback around the police response, and we try to take that and improve from it, but it's not an overnight fix.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'll bring in Katie Clark and then Colette Stevenson.
Thank you. And I was wanting to ask about the issue that I raised with the previous panel in relation to coercive control, and maybe just to get a little bit of information about your experience to date about how possible it's been to bring cases, what kind of conviction rates we're seeing, if maybe that there's not many cases and it's difficult to give a lot of data on that, but we as a committee haven't got much data, but also anything that can be said in terms of how easy it is or how difficult it is to secure prosecutions and convictions, and if there is any information in relation to that, the committee would be very interested. I don't know if there's any case law or whether you're able to give examples.
Of course. As the committee's heard, coercive controlling behaviour is a common form of abuse perpetrated against victims. And in the past, as prosecutors, we were limited in what charges we could bring to properly reflect that abuse, because we were limited to proving effectively single incidents or single offences. The new legislation has enabled us to present to the court the far bigger picture of what a victim has suffered, and also to provide evidence to the court about the context of individual incidents within that wider course of abusive behaviour. I could give you some examples, if it would be helpful, of the types of abusive behaviour which were not previously criminal, which we're now able to prosecute within the body of a Section 1 DASA charge. And that includes monitoring a victim's movements, restricting whether they can leave the house, isolating them from family and friends, monitoring their use of the phone, looking at their messages on the phone, constant accusations of infidelity, commenting on or controlling a victim's appearance, whether they wear certain clothing, wear makeup, making demeaning comments, all of which were not previously criminal, but can now be encompassed within the body of a Section 1 DASA charge. The Act has also allowed us to include within the body of a Section 1 DASA charge incidents which we might not previously have been able to libel because we couldn't corroborate them as individual standalone crimes. And, for example, provided that we can establish that there is a course of abusive behaviour, in that we can corroborate that course of abusive behaviour because we can prove two distinct separate elements of it, we can libel other incidents of abusive behaviour within the body of the DASA charge, even if they would not be able to be proved as a standalone offence. And there have been two recent High Court convictions, because DASA can carry up to 14 years imprisonment for offences which incorporated what would otherwise have been significant sexual offending, possibly, which could have amounted to rape. So we have been able to achieve justice for those victims in those cases by application of the new legislation. And the approach which prosecutors have applied has been approved in recent judgments from the High Court.
And I appreciate what you said previously and all the witnesses said in relation to sentencing, and that it's not your role to set sentencing guidelines. But you do have a role in terms of the consistency of sentencing, and on occasions, I appreciate it may be rare, you will lodge appeals in relation to sentencing. So do you think there is a consistent approach across Scotland in relation to these cases, or have you had to, if you like, you know, mark appeals?
As prosecutors, we apply a consistent approach to all cases of domestic abuse, mm-hmm. but I can't comment on sentencing at all, I'm sorry.
All right, so you can't even go that far. And also, just very briefly, you'll be aware the committee is looking at new bail proposals at the moment. Has there been a change in practice as a result of this legislation? And could you outline whether that's had an impact in terms of bail in relation specifically to domestic abuse? We're aware of the Section 23 provisions, but has there been an increase in the use of remand in relation to domestic abuse cases as a result of these various new offences being brought in?
We will consistently apply the same approach to consideration of opposition to bail or consideration of whether special conditions of bail should be sought from the court in relation to all cases of domestic abuse. And to a large extent, that considers the risk of harm to victims and to children. But whether or not an accused person is remanded or special conditions are imposed is a matter for the court.
In terms of your marking of cases, though, has this changed?
No, we will apply the same approach, and we continue to apply the same approach in relation to marking, focusing on the public interest and particularly the aspect of risk and safety of victims and how that can be dealt with through seeking special bail conditions or opposing bail where appropriate.
So the existence of the new offences shouldn't really have made a significant difference in terms of the numbers being remanded?
The new offence is another tool which prosecutors can use in that it's another charge which we can use to address domestic abuse, but it doesn't fundamentally change the approach we take to domestic abuse.
Thank you, that's helpful. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'll bring in Colette Stevenson and then Russell Finlay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning. I'm kind of going to go with the same thread as the last panel before, and in terms of the victims and witnesses' experience. And we heard as well that children going through the system, you know, have had an adverse impact in coming forward and whatnot as well. And even within the report that they touched upon with the everyday heroes, there was one quote, and it was, you get trauma from the bad person, then more trauma from the people in the system. And that was from a child saying that. Can you tell me what wider work you're involved in terms of aiming to improve the experience of victims and witnesses in domestic abuse cases? And if I can take that to Moira, first of all, thanks.
All victims of domestic abuse and all children in all court cases are deemed vulnerable witnesses. As such, they are automatically entitled to use special measures when giving evidence in court. They are also automatically referred to our Victim Information and Advice Service within COPFS, who will provide information about the case and also make links for the witness or the child to specialist support agencies to help support them and to help them to remain engaged within the criminal justice process.
Okay, can I put that to Craig? Thanks.
Yeah, I think the prosecution is, you know, taking the steps very seriously in terms of ensuring that victims and other witnesses are protected in court. It is a very difficult situation because you often are dealing with the parent of the child or the spouse of the victim. Providing support through third sector organisations can make a huge difference. The difficulty we've got in Scotland is that these third sector organisations are often locally based and very often not national organisations or nationally replicated across the country. So ensuring that there is an equivalence of service right throughout the country can be difficult. We did recommend that Police Scotland should implement changes to enhance the response at the first point of contact for more complex areas of work such as public protection. And that's looking about how do we provide wider support to people going through this. So it's not just about seeing the police officer, not just seeing people who are doing the investigation, but it's who else can provide support in the community and in the wider world around the individuals that are involved in this.
Okay, thanks. And if I could come to you, Sam. The other thing as well, even just from the evidence that we're given from the interviews, from the sample interviews, was the lack of support and signposting as well from when they're trying to report it to police and actually being taken serious. And I just wonder if you could maybe say more about that.
Are you speaking in general terms about victims or about child victims?
Particularly children.
Children. So I think the police approach to dealing with children, not in the nicest way to put it, but how we engage with children has changed significantly over the last few years. Very much of a risk-based approach. We try to adopt a trauma-informed approach. It's very much multi-agency. So you'll be aware that we're developing and we're rolling out the Scottish Child Interview Model. In cases of domestic abuse, certainly we are using visually recorded interviews for children who have been witnesses for significant cases, or high court cases for domestic abuse. And And also we're engaged with other organisations who are looking to roll out Barnahus, the Barnahus model, including the Scottish Government and Children First, who were mentioned earlier. We do try to seek children's views, and we take on board all the research that shows that children need to feel included and they need to feel heard in this. So where it's appropriate, we'll try to seek their views, but for an actual interview of a child, there's a very, very careful approach to that.
OK, thanks.
OK,
no further questions. Thanks, Gavina.
Thank you. I'll bring in Russell Finlay and then Rona Mackay.
Thanks very much. Now, the Police Scotland written submission was really detailed and helpful. And on page 9 of that, it makes reference to two cases which Muir Price has already, you've already referred to. And these are cases in which DASA was used to prosecute successfully rapes within a DASA charge, which otherwise would have been uncorroborated and not prosecuted. Now, these are both subject of appeal, and I'm not going to ask you to predict the outcome of that. But what I would like to ask is, it's a two-part question, is have these appeals had any, or have they got any bearing just now on current DASA cases specifically, I suppose, are any of them on pause that incorporate a rape charge or a rape element because of the appeals? And in the worst case scenario, if these are successfully appealed, does that fundamentally derail DASA for that purpose? And that's a question for yourself.
I'm not aware of any pause being put in relation to the way we apply DASA in light of any appeals which may be ongoing. But in fact, there's been a recent case from the High Court of CA against Her Majesty's Advocate, which actually endorses the approach which the Crown has always taken to the interpretation of DASA and confirms the approach which the Crown take.
So that's an appeal that's been through? Or
It's a concluded case.
Uh-huh.
And a decision issued by the High Court.
OK, so I don't know, maybe that case is the same as these two referred to in the police submission, but
That case doesn't relate to an allegation of significant sexual offending within the body of the charge, as far as I'm aware.
Right, but it's more about the application of DASA, right?
Yes.
So these, it's a kind of question of what's the space, and as to whether this could derail DASA, potentially, if these were successfully appealed.
I don't understand that the appeal cases would, if cases are being appealed, would necessarily derail DASA, particularly given the fact that the High Court has recently issued a judgment which appears to confirm the understanding and interpretation of the legislation which the Crown has always applied to the legislation.
Sure. OK, thank you. My second question is for DCS Faulds. Now, the Edinburgh University research that was referred to in the earlier evidence in which 22 victims talked about their experiences was quite critical. In fact, Dr. Houghton, who I think is still with us, described it as unremittingly grim. And in relation to police, it talks about the process being inconsistent and victims and witnesses being required to proactively collect and push for particular evidence to be considered, and you know, evidence of that nature, which I'm sure you're aware of. Now, I completely understand that everything revolves around funding. The Chief Constable has already stated that the current policing model is unsustainable on the basis of the funding model that is available to them. But what I would like to ask is, in your written evidence, there's talk of 13,000 officers having had the core training and 600 having had the what's called champion training. And in reply to the convener earlier, I think she asked about what was happening next, or if any deadlines or any targets. Mm. Can you give an indication as to whether that training is now back on track, what the targets are, where you're likely to go from here?
So we have been working with Safe Lives, who obviously helped us to deliver the DAMS training in the first place, and there are six continuous professional development modules have been developed and signed off with Safe Lives for delivery to the champions. And the intention then is that the champions who are distributed across the organisation will help to support frontline officers or officers within contact command and control division, if you like, around that whole decision making for them, and to support them with additional training and information, and to try and cascade that out. So that training is due to commence just shortly, but forgive me, I would need to check the timeline and come back to you on that.
Of course, yeah.
But I can't remember the timeline for it. But the six modules are ready and we will be pushing them out to the champions.
I was going to ask you a very quick supplementary of Mr. Naylor about that. Does HMICS have any remit around training and targets, and can you kind of hold the police to account in certain ways? Or?
Certainly. We made a recommendation in our last report about training, and we would be expecting within 3 months of publication of the report an updated plan from Police Scotland on what the training is. I've no reason to believe we won't get that. They're usually very good at following up on the recommendations and actually making a significant difference when they do. So we would expect to see the details that DCS Falls, sorry, called you McCluskey, DCS Falls has mentioned there on the nature of the training, the champions training, and we've talked about the champions in our report and how they need to be empowered.
So
to
do more. We'll see that within 3 months?
It'll come to us within 3 months. I suspect it will come to the SPA at some point around about then as well.
And a very quick question. We heard from the previous panel about civil and criminal cases where domestic abusers use the civil courts to sometimes prolong the abuse or play one criminal off against civil and vice versa. In particular case of dealing with the individual has been frustrated that the Legal Aid Board appears blind to what's going on. There's an organised crime element to it. There's previous convictions. There's the hiding of assets, allegedly, but it looks like this individual is going to get legal aid. I wonder if there's any mechanism at all that the police have for feeding into legal aid decisions of that nature. Is there any protocol or memorandum of understanding or sharing of information?
Specifically around the granting of legal aid applications?
I suppose, yeah, cases where you may be aware that individuals are seeking to obtain legal aid and they're not being honest. There's serious, perhaps serious organised crime or convictions of a domestic nature that are influencing it. It's all part of this culture of using civil legal aid to prolong or to continue the abuse that's criminal. Just if there's any mechanism the police have of talking to the Legal Aid Board.
So firstly, I wholeheartedly agree that the civil process is often used manipulatively and to continue to perpetrate abuse against victims, but I'm not aware of any structured feedback process or information sharing protocol or memorandum between us and the civil courts or the Scottish Legal Aid. We do have a lot of engagement with them, but I'm not aware of that, anything particular to that.
So maybe potentially of value to consider?
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay,
thank you very much. And if I can maybe just ask members to keep questions focused on Domestic Abuse Act that we're looking at today. So I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay and then Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon. Can I ask DCS Sam Falls first, really in the previous line of questioning that I had to the other panel about domestic abuse protection orders and possibility of stalking protection orders. I'm not sure how much you can say about any kind of discussions you've had with government about the implementation of these, or even just where what your view of it, what difficulties might exist.
Significant engagement with Scottish Government colleagues and with our partners in the justice system around the legislation. I think it's fair to say that it's not just the police who have raised concerns, and our concerns are not simply financial concerns or around resource demand. We've had concerns around risk and how the legislation might be implemented, which we have fed back, and we've had a number of very productive meetings between all the kind of justice partners and the Scottish Government to highlight all of the issues that we are collectively seeing. But it's not seen as an unsolvable problem. And we are actually really frantically working towards a solution for domestic abuse protection orders. So it's not that we are certainly not trying to put a barrier up. We're asking how can we overcome these challenges. We're not trying to point fingers. We're trying to overcome the hurdles that we can see in front of us.
I appreciate that. Yeah, no, totally appreciate that. And it is good to hear. And obviously,
it has to be right. You can't yeah. embark upon it if there's certain issues that haven't been ruled out, because the benefit to the victim would be that they don't have to go down the civil route, and they can avoid the expense and the stress of having to do that. If that can be worked out, that would be excellent. Can anyone else in the panel like to have a view on it? Anybody? Mr. Naylor, are you?
We haven't been involved in these conversations because we would look at the outcome and how the police service and justice would be developing the capability and improving it. But more sort of philosophically, very much in support of new powers and legislation to protect people. If we can do that and do that effectively in a way that balances budgets and challenges that are in resources and gets the best outcome for victims and their families, then very, very supportive.
I mean, I personally think it would be a game changer if it can be done effectively and all parties are, you know, able to do it without a great deal of hassle. Moira, would you have a view?
As an organisation, we're equally supportive of anything which can be done to further protect victims of domestic abuse, though in relation to this particular legislation, the involvement of prosecutors would really come in the event of a breach of such an order, which would be a crime. Prosecutors would not be involved in seeking these orders,
of course,
in
yeah.
terms of the legislation.
Yeah. Can I just ask a very quick question to you, Moira? And I'm sorry, I may have missed this when Katie Clark was speaking. How do you differentiate between DASA legislation and, you know, other legislation? What's the criteria that you would say, well, you know, that's clearly DASA and that isn't? Is there anything concrete you could tell us?
It really comes down to the facts and circumstances of the individual case. There are certain legal rules which we need to be able to comply with to prove a DASA charge, namely, can we prove that it's a course of abusive behaviour? Does the behaviour meet the criteria set down in the legislation? If it does, then we can prove a DASA charge. We will generally prosecute in terms of DASA. Sometimes we can't prove a DASA charge, but can prove individual incidents under the existing common law or statutory provisions. So it will depend on each case, and each and every case is considered on its own individual facts and circumstances.
Great. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Yeah, thanks very much. Bring in Pauline McNeill and then Fulton McGregor. Pauline.
Thanks. Good afternoon. Thank you for that evidence so far. I found it really helpful. And I found really helpful, Moira, your responses to Katie Clark on the coercive behaviour. It's just kind of following from that, and also to ask Sam's view on it as well. So we'd previously heard evidence that, I'll just quote directly, that Tier 1's response officers, I'll put that to you, Sam, Tier 1's response officers tend to go out to domestic violence abuse cases, and that they're not specialists, naturally, because they're on the front line, whereas maybe more specialist officers or officers which are trained to identify, and I'm particularly interested in the coercive behaviour side of things. Now, I imagine by the very nature of that crime, it's always going to be difficult to identify or indeed provide the evidence on a course of conduct. But I just wondered if you had anything to offer the committee on what you thought about how better we could identify coercive behaviour issues on the front line.
I think we still have a long way to go in terms of training and understanding and awareness of officers of what constitutes coercive control, and that whole, to be able to get them to recognise the impact across the relationship and not just taking incidents in isolation. Tier 1 response, there was a comment earlier about them being slaves to the radio, so if I can put that into context, not every domestic incident call to the police will result in a crime being established. There is a big percentage of them that are no crime incidents. Overnight, we'll see anywhere between 140 and 150 calls to the police for domestic abuse, but you'll also see an excess of 400 calls for concerns for people. You'll see an excess of 100 missing persons overnight, etc. That's the demand that's on frontline officers. And I don't think it's fair if we don't recognise that they don't always get the time to sit down and build enough of a relationship with victims. Where a crime has been established, and it's not evidenced immediately, that's where the Tier 2 will pick that up. And we do have specialist officers in Tier 2. To give a platinum service, we would have Tier 1. Everybody would be a specialist domestic abuse officer, but we just don't have the resources mm-hmm. to do that, and that's why we have domestic abuse champions. That's why we have, within each division, specialist domestic abuse officers to pick it up the following day, to do safety planning, to do perpetrator management planning, mm-hmm. to engage with the victim and obtain fuller statements. But to send a specialist officer out to 150 calls a night is we probably
yeah,
just don't have
that. Thanks for that, and I wasn't suggesting that. I totally yeah. accept that we need our front line. Moira, I wanted to ask you a follow-on from that. So I guess, if you can answer it, does coercive behaviour tend to go along with physical abuse, or is there any patterns? Is it a standalone crime? Because what I'm trying to visualise, also based on what Sam said, it obviously can be a standalone crime. That's the point of the act, a course of conduct over a long period, and coercive behaviour. It's not physical abuse, mental abuse. So I wouldn't have thought, it's just my perception of it, I wouldn't have thought you're going to lift the phone at some point and say, I think that there's been a crime against me because of queer. I'm trying to visualise how then would you capture coercive behaviour? Does it tend to coincide then with physical abuse? If you could help me in that, Moira, that would be helpful.
Each incident of abuse will be particular to that accused and to that particular victim. So some courses of behaviour might well include violence, threatening, intimidating behaviour, all of which would be crimes mm-hmm. anyway, but some might not. And what we've learned from the academic research and from the voice of experience provided to us by victim support organisations and the task force is that often with coercive control, it's not the use of violence, but the threat of violence, which can be as powerful and have as significant impact on the victim. So yes, in some cases, we might see violence alongside coercive control type behaviour, but in other cases, we wouldn't necessarily see violence.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I thought that's what you'd say. I'm trying to work out where there's no violence then, how are you picking it up? How could you possibly pick up cases where there's been... Because you've mentioned that you knew there's been a couple of cases already and the judgment has endorsed the Crown approach to this, which is good. How would they be picked up then if there's no physical abuse? I'm really struggling to see how you would get into the system.
Through a victim reporting
right.
crime.
So they just simply do just report that like any other crime and they say, I think, yeah, OK, thank you. Greg, you looked like you wanted to say something there.
This is something we struggled with in our inspection report about trying to understand the intersection between people who are victims of sexual crime, people who are victims of domestic abuse, who are victims of coercive control, and how they almost like a Venn diagram, you know, layer on top of each other. And understanding the individual journey to get to a point of reporting is really important, because sometimes you'll get the reporting of the sexual crime, sometimes domestic. Rarely coercive control on its own.
Right.
But generally what you will find is when you start exploring into the depths of the victim's journey, you will find more than just one aspect. You may find an initial physical mm-hmm. assault as domestic abuse. You then find their phones being controlled, their bank accounts being controlled. You may find, I think as you described in these two cases, elements of sexual crime that you would struggle to prove as standalone sexual crimes, but because they sit within a DASA framework, that elements of the DASA legislation can be used on that. So it is very difficult, it's very complex to try and peel it apart and mm-hmm. say, you will always see, for example, on this occasion, this is what you'll see. It doesn't work like that. It needs to understand the victim mm-hmm. and how you deal with that victim and build their confidence, build their trust, and get to a position where they tell you the whole story. Because very often that will take weeks, months to do that.
That's really helpful. Thank you very much.
I wonder if I could just, before I bring in Fulton McGregor, just pick up a bit on that and maybe come to yourself, Moira, in terms of proofing a DASA charge that requires proof of, sort of ongoing behaviour, as we've heard. However, while, I suppose hypothetically, whilst
Crown Office is potentially waiting on such kind of sustained behaviour. In the meantime, we've got a victim who's potentially still living at risk of harm and potentially quite high risk. So would Crown Office potentially prioritise single charges on other offences sort of in the interim?
There is a difference between summary procedure and solemn procedure. Mm-hmm. If an accused is reported and placed on a summary complaint, the charges are effectively crystallised at the point the accused appears in summary complaint, mm-hmm. though we do have power to raise subsequent proceedings or to move to amend the complaint if further information comes in. Right. Whereas if we raise solemn proceedings where the accused initially appears in petition, that period will then be followed by investigation, which would enable us to receive further information and perhaps change the charges before the accused is finally served with an indictment. Mm-hmm. But generally, we'll base the charges based on the available information. Mm-hmm. If there appears to be scope for further investigation, we will instruct that of the police. Every case will depend on its own facts and circumstances. Mm-hmm. We would certainly not be waiting for the victim to suffer further abuse before we raise proceedings. Mm-hmm. If there is sufficient evidence to enable us to raise proceedings and to seek, for example, protective bail orders in the interim. Mm-hmm.
That's helpful. Thanks very much for that. Fulton McGregor-Bean.
Thanks, Convener. And it's actually following on from Pauline and yourself's line of questioning and the line of questioning that I had for the previous panel, and that is about, I suppose, victim confidence in the legislation, or not even victim confidence, that's probably not the right word, it's the public confidence, public realising that there is a new offence there, and that this is as wrong as a physical assault. And I suppose there is probably mirror images between the two, because, you know, from all the evidence that we've heard, that historically speaking, domestic violence wouldn't have always been seen as an offence, you know, several decades ago. But I think now most people do understand, whether they report it or not, it's completely a different matter, and there's control issues around that. But we now know that most people do understand that an assault on them is an offence. How do you think we can get to that same place with this offence in the wider public? Because I'm assuming that you, both the police in terms of in the Crown, will have heard of situations where you've maybe went out and your officers have maybe said this is potentially an offence, and maybe the victim's been, is it? You know, is there anything more we can do? Is there anything more this committee and the Parliament can do to promote that? I'm quite happy with any order.
I completely agree that increasing public understanding and public awareness of the offence and of domestic abuse in general is essential to us being able to tackle it as a society. And as Sam and Craig have both said in different answers, it's so important to effect a societal and a cultural and a generational change in how we deal with domestic abuse. I think that the more that victims have confidence to come forward and see that they achieve justice, the more that's reported, the more the public in general will understand just how seriously criminal justice agencies treat this type of offending and have the confidence to report. If they themselves are not the victims, report what they see happening to friends, neighbours, relatives, so that the organisations who can take action are able to take action.
Yeah, and I remember when we were taking the legislation through in the last parliamentary session, as I said before, I was on the committee, and there was a lot of talk about the legislation, while bringing a new offence, was also trying to change the culture around. And I remember, you know, MSPs from all parties speaking about that in the debates. Do you think that we are changing the culture, Sam, if I can come to yourself? And do you think we're on the right track, if you like?
I think it's maybe started, but there's still a long way to go. And it's not just about public awareness about the new DASA offence, because domestic abuse is an umbrella term and it captures the whole spectrum of abuse, whether that's physical, sexual or non-physical abuse, psychological abuse of victims. And for me, to get ahead of the curve. We really need to start early with education. So for us, we developed, and that's just one programme among many, the UME Together programme, which we would hope to get pushed out into as many schools as possible. And that's for boys and girls, right? Because the definition's not gender specific. Mm. And that's about that education starting as young an age as appropriate and as possible. But I can't dictate what's on the educational curriculum, but I do think that we need to start with education and start to get ahead of the curve for that societal change that we all know is needed, because policing in isolation is not going to solve this.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. Maybe some overlap up there with the education.
Okay.
Just wanted to know if Craig wants to add anything to that.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with everything Moira and Sam have said, and that seems to be a common theme, but maybe pulling from a slightly different field, I was delighted to be present when Sam and her team got an award recently for the That Guy campaign, which is about sexual offending and dealing with the offender. I think there's some really good parallels for this, and I think there's some really good opportunities to pursue how that is done to tackle wider understanding about DASA legislation, to tackle the offender and how they think. And I know there's been work done by forces in England and Wales about tackling offender behaviour, particularly understanding what the people around the offender see and understand, to see the sort of development and the sort of spiral of the increase in the domestic abuse through coercive control, etc. I think learning from that and understanding it more widely, and then taking that back into Scottish Government and understanding the responsibilities of the Parliament in pushing that forward will be fantastic, as well as policing, education, health and all the other statutory bodies that will need to be involved.
Thank you. That's good.
Thank you. And I'll bring in Jamie Green to finish things off.
Thank you. Two short supplementaries. The first follows on nicely from the conversation we've just had. Of course, the best way to deal with domestic abuse is prevention rather than cure. And on that, I wondered if the panel was confident and comfortable that that the delivery of what is known as Clare's Law has been effective in Scotland through the Domestic Violence Disclosure Scheme. First of all, if Police Scotland had any statistical data on how many people have applied through that scheme for information and been granted information in the positive since its launch. And secondly, whether Police Scotland's data systems are up to scratch in terms of a national register and pulling together information relevant to be able to feed into those requests.
The disclosure scheme for Domestic Abuse Scotland obviously was introduced as Clare's Law down south, but DS-DAS, as it's known up here. We've seen that the applications to the scheme, and there are two routes in, so a victim or a concerned family member can make an application for us, you know, the right to ask, and then police officers, other professionals can make an application via the Power to Tell scheme. And what we've seen consistently since 2016 is an increase in applications to the scheme. We've seen an increase in disclosures. Not every application will result in a disclosure. It's very much a risk-based multi-agency decision whether or not we make that disclosure. Particularly during the pandemic, during COVID, we saw a real increase. And I can come back to you in writing with figures if that's helpful with the statistics for that. But we saw a real increase in applications to the scheme, both in the right to ask, but also in the power to tell, which gave me a bit of confidence that officers were still responding to domestic abuse during the pandemic, still recognising risk and making applications themselves for victims or potential victims to be given the right information for them to make informed decisions about their own relationships, their own lives. Mm-hmm. So I can come back to you with statistics. It's really pretty high. I would have said somewhere, and I might be wrong, but I think it's around 9,000, but not applications, okay. But not all of them have resulted in a disclosure. Certainly, when we compared it to Clare's Law, the use of the scheme in Scotland was much better.
Okay. And that's really what I was trying to unearth, is how successful that scheme's been comparatively. And obviously we know there are sex offenders registers, but there isn't a centralised domestic offenders register as such. But there is other data sets out there that people can access through the scheme, which may be helpful to them.
I think what's really important to remember is, so the sex offender register is conviction based. Mm-hmm. The disclosure scheme for domestic abuse in Scotland is based on relevant information and intelligence. It's not based solely on conviction data And that's important because not everybody gets prosecuted, not everybody gets convicted, not everybody gets, you know, so we have to have take all of the information into account to allow somebody to be empowered themselves by that info. So yeah. It is not conviction based, and that's a real positive of the scheme.
Yeah, and I presume there are safeguards to ensure that people aren't obtaining information maliciously, for example, for false premises. So that's a helpful safeguard.
A very considered scheme. Yeah. It obviously takes into account human rights provisions, etc., and whether we've got a lawful basis to do that. But it's very much a multi-agency. There's a decision-making forum before we will go to that individual and give them information.
I'd kindly request then, if you do have any more information on that scheme to write to us with any data that you have, I'd find that really helpful.
As we
post-legislative scrutiny. And while you're on the line, you'll be aware in my last session I asked about male survivors of domestic abuse. What is your gut feeling about how Police Scotland deal with reports of that? And I know you're going to say lots of positive things about good work that is done on the front line, but is there any sense at all that officers deal with these types of reports differently, or are you comfortable that everyone's fully trained to deal with a man reporting domestic abuse and that he'll be dealt with in the same way as anybody else?
So I think I already mentioned our definition is inclusive, it's not gender specific, albeit we recognise a disproportionate impact on female victims. The officer's training is to include every victim. It doesn't exclude male victims of domestic abuse, it's inclusive of it. Certainly the specialist training has lived experience. We engage with AMIS, they form part of the National Forum. We take feedback from AMIS all the time around what we could do to improve. I would quite like to do some media work with them, but there are some budgetary restrictions around what I can and can't do, and I have to target campaigns and messaging to the biggest audience that I can make a difference with. But we do recognise that there are male victims. So.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think that brings us nicely to the end of our session. Just before you do leave, you've obviously been answering our questions this morning, and we're grateful for that. I just wondered if any of you would like to just make a final comment around what we need to be thinking about specifically that perhaps has not been articulated this morning already, as we continue our post-legislative scrutiny of the Act, that perhaps hasn't been reflected already, if there's just any final point that you would like to raise. So come to Moira, Craig, Sam.
From the prosecution's perspective, this has been a very positive development. The use of this legislation has allowed us to lead evidence from witnesses in a way that lets them tell their full story, whereas before we would have had to artificially stop them partway through the story to move on to ask them about the next incident. Our perspective is that the legislation works well and represents the fact that it was based on very good collaborative work from a number of criminal justice agencies in advance and was designed and developed based on experience of investigating and prosecuting and the lived experience of domestic abuse. There's nothing further I could add to the committee in relation to changes to be proposed.
Thanks very much. Craig.
Thank you, Convener. I would echo those comments. I think it's a good piece of legislation. I think the training that's been done in both organisations has made a huge difference. But I don't think we can arrest our way out of this problem. I think this is a wider societal issue that we need to be thinking more about prevention. Where we do get to the point of cure, I think we're getting better at that. Mm-hmm. But prevention has got to be the next target on the list.
Yep, indeed. And Sam, finally.
This is probably a very tactical comment, but previously, as the lead of the Tier 3 response, I've really seen the benefit of the legislation because officers investigating domestic abuse with repeat perpetrators, multiple relationships, mm-hmm. etc., yeah. often were very frustrated that they were capturing evidence of abuse that wasn't criminalised at that point in time. So the legislation for us has made a huge difference, particularly in these Tier 3 with repeat perpetrators. Or perpetrators with multiple victims. So For us, it has really made a difference on the ground, but as Mr. Naylor says, we recognise we still have a long way to go.
Thanks very much. Thank you very much indeed. So that concludes our public session this morning. Thanks again for joining us, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.